So hey guys, this session is being recorded. Please check whether you see that red color indicator, whether the thing is being recorded or not. If you don't see, please tell me. The recording means that your audio, video, and your whatever you say might be recorded, might be visible to other people. Okay, last time, what we were doing is actually playing out this scenario of using Git. And we were very, very simply trying to avoid use of terminal to the extent possible. To just first make a solid understanding. So we discussed this thing called Tinker Toys, right? And some of you may have watched that four years and up Git video, which is kind of beautiful. So each of these is a commit hash. So we have to do a commit, which means it saves the state of the thing, whatever your folder is, right? It saves the content and everything. It saves the state. So for every commit, there is a state. Every commit, another state. Commit, another state, which means we can transition from up and down if you like, or wherever we feel like, you know, any direction. And so that was just a linear tree. So it just went like this. But the thing that we want to do now is I started this Badal folder, and then I added a.txt and I don't remember if I added any other file, but let's check. So in the GitHub Cloud Genius, the file added right now is only one, a.txt. I think this is what you will see. So only one file right now, which is this file. So at this moment, we have the original initialization state. This is the state. And then we have another state called the file added, that state. So that's two states available. Now, many of you, what you have done, at least four or five of you, is you have forked it. And a fork is basically, I don't need to tell you what a fork is, but fork is something like this. You're basically creating a fork, right? So this big Git branch, the tree structure that I'm beginning to build, you forked it. And then you made a change. And then you say, okay, please take my change. That's what you're saying. So please take my change. And that is a fork operation. And this one is a pull request. This operation that you're doing is a PR. And this is a fork operation. That's what you just did. So some of you did it. Now, not everybody, so I'm going to show it to you. So what I'm going to do is go to pull request, or go to that project, not this. Okay, this one. So this is the project we have. And so if I am a different user, not this Nilesh user, which is what I would like to actually get, is a volunteer from one of you. So if you have a person who has not done the pull request yet, I would like to actually ask you to volunteer so I can basically
transfer. I'll volunteer. This is Rebecca.
Okay. So I'm going to hand off control to you, which means...
Sure, because I'm having an issue. I don't know what I'm doing wrong, but the new file is grayed out, and I don't know what else I need to do to verify my email address. I don't know if anybody else is having this trouble.
So let's figure it out, and we'll hand over control to Rebecca. Rebecca will drive the display. She will be able to project her laptop, and there it comes. And we will look at a couple of things. First of all, chat, you're going to the Badal group, project. And in that project, what you are going to do the first thing is you want to actually verify your account. By that thing might cause trouble somewhere. So go to your Earth link and just click through the verification. So it will go away. So there
Is
the, you have to verify that you are the owner of that email, which you haven't.
Okay. How do I do that? So I went to my email.
Go to Earth link, look for an email for verification.
There it is.
And so just click that link. Maybe not.
Which one? I've clicked on all of them.
Okay.
More than once.
So go back to that page, and there is a link to resend it. So the browser.
Go back to
browser.
Sorry, this email.
Web browser.
Which page?
A web browser.
This page.
Yeah. Configure email settings. It says somewhere there, And
Yeah, I did that. This is to configure a new email address.
okay, click on the emails exclamation and
Right?
resend the verification on the right side. Resend verification
On the right side,
on the right side.
resend.
So all the way, all the end at the right side. There we go,
Right.
resend. And so look for your new email. And there should be an email saying that, you know what, please verify. That will come in a moment, because without this verification, GitHub will not let you deal with it. It will not let you do anything much.
Right.
That email will come, and that is one of the reasons why it will not let you do anything further unless you verify. So that email is coming whenever it does.
Okay. Well, maybe you need to pass it to somebody else. I haven't been able to get past this step, so.
Okay, so that verification is stuck, which is one of the reasons why it will not let you do anything. Let us identify another volunteer if there is one more.
I can volunteer.
Okay, so Shikha, I'm
This is
transporting
Shikha.
control to you. There we go. Shikha is the presenter now, and you may present. And so we'll look at your Gmail. Sorry, the GitHub. Why do I call it Gmail? And so, yeah, let's see, look at GitHub and please project. And we'll see what's going on. It's very, very trivial exercise. What we are doing is going to fork it, make a change, send a pull request. Three steps, all in the browser, nothing else. So just to get the concept right. Once we get the concept right, we'll get to that command line business and do complex things. So right now, you seem to have already created a okay, let's go look. Let's go look. So you have already done the work, apparently, Shikha. So go to Cloud Genius Badal, click on the Cloud Genius Badal word, Badal. Now there, apparently you have forked it. You have clicked the fork button already, right? Did you? There is a fork button at the very right corner. Fork. I think you probably forked it already. Did you fork? I suspect so. So what you probably did is you forked it. So click on the fork button one more time. It'll take you to your fork. So this are the variety of forks. So your fork was, so all these four people have done the forks. So Shijatsu, H. Koger, Giselle, and A. R. Ramos. These four people have forked the repository already. So I would like you to click the fork button, which will basically fork it. Create a fork in the main tree. And so let us do that. Click the button fork, not the number 9, but the word fork. Can you hear me okay? Shika? Yeah, click the fork button, please. And now it is asking you, where do you want to fork? So you say, go to my fork, because you already have forked it. So you visit your fork. So what you are doing, looking at right now, is your fork of the Cloud Genius. You can see that change in the upper left corner where it says Shijatsu slash Badal, fork from Cloud Genius Badal. So this, what you're looking at, is a entirely a different but related structure in Git that relates to the Cloud Genius Badal, but is a fork. Meaning you have the authority to change things here. In the Cloud Genius account, you don't. I have the authority to change it. So this is a fork of that account. You can make changes here. And so let us see. Can you make a change? Did you make a change? I would like you to make a change by creating a new file. There is a new file button in the middle of the page. New file. And so that is what you will do to create a new file, and you will choose an alphabet, one of those. So I don't remember, but just pick something like letter T dot txt. So this is, you're typing something inside the body of the file, but your file name is just above that, a little bit above. Click, and that's the name of the file, should be T dot txt, and then go scroll down all the way. That's the file name you put. That's most important right now. The name of the file, the contents do not really matter. Then commit. Then you are committing a new item called t as in telephone dot txt, and you tried creating the t dot txt got created just now. So you have to now, sorry, let me recap. What you did was forked it, forked the Cloud Genius repo. which resulted in Shijatsu Badal repo. Different repo, but a fork. It is still connected to the main CloudGenius repository. However, here, this is a fork. You have the authority to change. So you did. What did you do? You created a new file called t.txt, t as in telephone. And now you have the change. So now your folder contains two things. One of them, the a.txt, which I did. And you now have the t.txt added just now. Great. Now, what do you want to do? You want to send me a request to please pull my changes. Okay, you cannot push your changes. That's the problem. Because you cannot push because you don't have the authority to write into CloudGenius. So all you can do is request for me to pull. And that's what you're doing right now. Again, what you're doing is requesting Nilesh to please pull. Because you cannot push. You don't have the permissions yet. So that's what you're doing. Now you read the screen. It is very, very clear. It says, you are creating a pull request and you are changing one file. In the bottom of the page, you will see one file changed with one addition, no deletion. And you can see what the change is. It's a new file added called t.txt. And now you can click the green button to request me to pull this change. So that's what you're doing. You're saying, hey Nilesh, would you please pull this? That's what you will write. Or maybe in the body of the message, you'll write, can you please pull this? And in the description, you will also say that, you know what, I have created this file called t.txt. So would you please pull it? And then you send that request over to me. It'll automatically go to me because the linkage is already there. You know where it came from. The fork came from the original. So as soon as you say create pull request, that's the end of the exercise. Now, the rest of the exercise is with me. So what I'm going to do is change the presenter to myself. And I'm going to show you my screen. In my screen, you're going to look at the same location, but this time I have 10 pull requests. Wow. You guys are working, really. And so there we have 10 pull requests. Let's go process them one by one. Let's understand what you have done. So right now, I have not processed any pull requests whatsoever. So in my notification screen, in this one, I have some pull requests. Let's mark them all red. Go back to that same location where I came from and back to the Badal group. And in here, I can identify all the pull requests right in this location. These are the people requesting me to pull something. Let us go process them one at a time. So go pull requests. And there are lots of them. So here, I'll see the very first one 2 days ago, created j.txt. Good, Giselle did that. Let us go read the pull request before we accept it. I may not accept. I may accept. Depending on what there's a typical scenario is when you're merging like this, when you're accepting pull requests, you're typically reviewing the contents of the item in a team setting. You're looking at it collectively. Hey, is that j.txt done correctly? Let us go look at the commit. And so Giselle has committed this, which is nice. Let us look at Giselle's file. What does the file contain? Giselle's file. Well, we really don't worry about or care too much about the content of the file. All we care about is the name of the file. Is the name exactly what we want? Apparently so, yes. So it looks like good. So what I'm going to do is I'm going to accept this change and I'll say, you know, thank you, Giselle. And then I'll comment. But just by commenting, it doesn't mean anything yet. I have to actually actively incorporate this pull request and take it. How do I do that? I'll go back to that pull request page and look at that pull request, the j.txt again, and then merge the pull request. Merge. When I do this activity, merging, I'm making a note that I am creating j.txt based on a pull request from Giselle, which is already there. So I'm going to just confirm the merge, and now, after confirming that merge, I do have the choice to revert it if I like, but I don't need to. What I'll do is go back to Badal, and this time I have two files, A and J. Beautiful. Now what? So we are slowly working towards building our project, and we'll go look at our project itself in the Badal folder. What do we have? Only one file, a.txt. But I thought we just approved the pull request from Giselle, and we have the j.txt right there in the GitHub location. Why do we not have it here in our folder? What's wrong? What's going on? Let's see. This Badal folder, it has the a.txt, but where is the j.txt that Giselle created? That is missing. Can you tell me why it is missing? Because this poor terminal does not know that something happened over at GitHub. It has no idea. So what do you think we should do right now to get the changes down to our laptop? This
Pull them
j.txt, I
down.
want it here. You want to pull it, right? So say git pull, as simple as that, and enter. And so git knows where to go and grab stuff because we set a remote for that. You recall the remote last time, git remote. It knows where to go from and get it from. So when we say pull, it'll go fetch it from that location. Fetch. So this location, which is basically the same location here, it'll go and pull. So all we have to do is say git pull, and you watch what happens. It pulls. And we have the file called Giselle showing up right there. This j.txt showed up. Beautiful. So now we have been able to bring the file, one change, one insertion, created this file. Beautiful. Now let us say git log. What do we see? So we have the first entry, a.txt created. Next, we have j.txt created by Giselle. And then next activity is I'm merging that pull request from Giselle into the main repository right here. And then I'm pulling it down. So now I have it. So we now have these two files. Great. We can very quickly do the others. Very, very quickly. Pull request. Let us see what's going on with k.txt. That's Giselle doing. I'll say merge pull request, confirm the merge. Awesome. And just thank her. This is nicety. You should do that always with team members. And back to Badal, look at other pull requests. And so we have E and f.txt. Great. Confirm the merge. Let us see other pull requests. We have S. Beautiful. Take that. Confirm that we have other pull requests. Let's see what have we got. Create Gautam.txt. Now the file name here apparently is called Gautam.txt. Now that is a pull request I cannot accept because the file name, the naming convention does not align with the project goal. So this pull request called Gautam.txt is something that I will like to say that, you know what? Sorry, Gautam. I cannot accept this. Sorry, Gautam. Can't accept this change because the file name does not fit the project convention. You know, the convention is it should be g.txt or something like that, abcd all the way, but not gotham.txt. So I'm going to comment on this issue and let Gotham agree to this. I can actually reject the change right away, but I just want to make sure that Gotham is aware. So I'm being nice in telling Gotham that, you know what, please review that and, you know, maybe withdraw your pull request, or if you don't withdraw, maybe I should just go and reject the pull request. That rejection is also possible. There is another thing you can do, which is to ignore a pull request. You don't have to actually accept every request, pull request all the way. So we have this pull request, which is not what we want. It doesn't align with our project goal. So we can either, you know, reject it or just leave it alone. Deal with other things like Deepak Ramesh sent us d.txt. So we'll take that, merge it, and confirm merge. Let us see what we have by now. We are going to pull the Git repository, Git pull right now, so see what comes up. So we have lots of things coming up. D, E, F, S, K came along. So we have all these files accumulating right here. Let's go back to Badal finishing up all the activities, 6 pull requests, Y, E, M, and T, and C, D. So we have C, D. D cannot be taken, apparently somebody collided. So that collision will happen because Ramos already did that yesterday, and I just by mistake took this D from somebody else. So we'll have to deal with that. That collision. So this is a case of collision. We have to just handle it carefully. So we'll deal with that collision just a minute later. But in the meanwhile, I'm going to just accept these pull requests quickly. Y and merge. And so confirm the merge. Let us see, Badal, pull requests, E, please pull. So I'm going to, the conflict must be resolved. The conflict is because this e.txt probably already exists right there, and so you cannot add the e.txt from Carl. So you have to say, sorry, Carl, this is already done. So there's a collision. We cannot take your change because this commit includes e.txt. That file already exists in the main branch there. So right there, created by somebody else. Who was that? Yeah, Helen did that yesterday or the day before. So the change is that Carl has, not Carl, Cal, sorry for butchering your name. So Cal has done this e.txt, and he did it like 9 minutes ago. We have to say, sorry, we cannot take this, that is taken. This letter E is taken. Letter E is taken already. Sorry. And we don't need to take this. We just close the issue and say, you know what, letter is taken. Letter E is taken. Let's go look at Gautam. We can just close the pull request because this file naming convention is not correct. Keep going. 3. We got M. We take that and merge it and confirm the merge. Thank Michael. Badal pull request, 2 more. T. And T exists. No, it doesn't. So merge and confirm. And one last one, Badal, pull request and C and D. So we have conflicts. So C and D are conflicting, which means we can request, there are a couple of ways to handle this. We can either request Alex to create a fresh pull request with only the file D because the somebody created D afterwards. However, I took that change first before looking at this pull request, which came in a while ago. And so that change that we have done, this D.txt, he did it 2 days ago, like the very day the other day when we were meeting in the previous session. That's what he did. I should have taken that change right away, but I did not. And so I have to actually apologize to Alex, saying, sorry, Alex, we cannot take your change because I did a stupid mistake and I took a later change before yours. Although I should have taken your change.
Okay, I don't mind.
Yeah, thank you. So that's how it works in real life. You basically go and say, sorry. And, you know, so we cannot take this one. So, but we still need C, and so we need N. So we have this Michael N setting. Yes, so we'll take that pull request, confirm it, merge it, come back here, say git pull. And let us take a review of inventory. What do we got? We got most of the files already. Did we get all of them? Let us see. Not all of them yet. So let us identify the missing ones and just, you know, before I finish it off, I want to make sure that I check the Git log. And so in the log, you will see that different people are contributing, right? So here and here and here and here. Like the people are contributing, and you can see that these contributions are coming along, and we are basically building our goal. Our goal is to build that folder containing A through Z files like that. And so there are still some missing. So we'll finish it off. Or rather, you know, it's not really, really necessary to fill it off. But thank you, Alex. So the idea is to... So there is no interesting exercise in actually writing all the way A through Z. That's not the point. The point was, how do we use Git in the basic simplest way to contributions from different people spread out geographically and still pull out changes and create a folder containing what we wanted to begin with. So it is not a interesting exercise anymore to add the remainder like z.txt or some of the missing letters. That is not really interesting in my mind. So what I'm going to do is abandon this project primarily because, you know, it's not really that interesting anymore. Our goal is met. Our goal of making sure that we have understood this idea of a pull request. Basically, you are, you know, in the team, you're beginning to build out something which is what a linear progression, and you ask your team members, collaborators, geographically distributed, wherever, whatever time zone, to fork. And so you fork it, you make a change, and then you send a PR. And you
If two people check out, or sorry, do work on file A simultaneously at the same time, mm-hmm. and then submit a pull request, uh-huh. does that cause two forks on file A?
Yes, so correctly. This is the fork corresponding to person A. This is person B. This is person C. This is person D. So everybody has their own fork. That's the scenario that we just played with. And so if you look at the repository and the network, if you identify, there are lots and lots of people, and these people, refresh. So there are these people, and see how the graph is building up. You know, everybody is contributing. So we have Patrick contributed to the master. He created u.txt, apparently, that I haven't taken. But then this line, Gautam, I did not take. Carl, I did not take, but everybody else's, I took the changes. So see how they are merging all the way to the top branch, the main branch. And right now, that's where we are, right? We have taken up changes from Michael. We have taken change from Shijatsu, Michael again, Ted, 1966. Who's Ted? Huh, I forgot who Ted is. Somebody was Ted. Ted, 1966. I don't even know who that person is. How come I don't know?
That would be Ted M, I think.
Okay. Ted M. Okay, so we have Deepak Ramesh, we got Shijatsu, H. Kogar, Giselle, and Giselle. So that's the change that you see how I'm merging, pulling things together in form of one mainstream. This is what we call the main branch. And these are forks that all of us have. So that's a very loosely coupled way of operating. Very, very loose. You know, in fact, it is so loose that we are not even part of a team yet. Although I will be adding you guys to a team right now. So I think I have added most of you to a team, except not everybody. So we have a couple folks here. Deepak Ramesh needs to be added to the team. So I'm adding that, but that will take us to the next project, which is in Git again. But this time we'll do a little bit more complex, a little bit more cohesive in terms of a team structure. And I'll elaborate on that in just a minute. I'll just finish up adding our team member who is right here. So our team called Badal, no, not here. Cloud Genius teams, and then the Badal team. We have six members. So I'm adding Deepak Ramesh. And if there is anybody else that I need to add, I think I need to add Ted 1966, right, Ted? Is it Ted 1966, was it?
Yeah, that's my GitHub login.
Yeah, so we have four pending invitations. These guys have been invited, but they haven't yet accepted. So please accept your invitations to the in the upper section. Go to that location and here, on the bubble right next to your name here is where you will find those invitations pending. Please accept that, then you will have a membership to this group. And at that time, you may be able to edit some of the changes right in the main branch itself. So that's what the scenario we would like to play next. And what I'm going to basically do is continue, but this time I'm going to give you authority to edit, modify the repository itself. Please make sure that these pending invitations go away, meaning you please accept them. So AR, Ramos, Giselle, Helen, and Michael, please go to the upper section in the name where you have, and right there in the blue box, And there you go and accept the KiranThM. KiranThM.
It says I have zero unread notifications, but I do have an email, so maybe I could link from there.
Yeah, that's great. So that invitation should allow you to come on in the team, and then we will have all of us in the team, and then we'll do another exercise.
I have a question, please.
Yes.
You can accept the files, even if they're not team members, like you were able to check in files from a couple of people who were not even team members?
Yeah, it doesn't need to be. Pull request is like open to public.
Okay.
Anybody on the internet can basically fork. So we have this Git branch, sorry, the main branch, that's the main that I am operating. And in that main, I have basically marked that repository as public. And that is the reason why anybody on the internet, whether they are the team members or not, can fork. So very easy to fork. It's for public, right? That's how open source projects are handled. Open source projects are handled exactly like that. So you make the repository public. So anybody and their brother and sister can come and fork. And then operate, make changes, test it out, see if they like it. And if they like it, they feel happy, they send a pull request. And you accept it or reject it. And then if you do accept, they become contributors. That's great. But they still are not a part of the team. They're a part of the public domain. And people are contributing, building stuff just like this. Just like this. Now that next logical step to what you just did, you did browser usage, right? Just the browser. But for a complex setup, it is very hard, very difficult to use the browser. It's not a good tool. So for complexity, so what you need to do is you have this thing going, the main that you have, that I have created and started, made it public. And so one of you say forked it, right? So you have your own fork of this. So it basically has this original a.txt. And then you have this, let's call it shijatsu / bother. And that's the repository location on GitHub, which is forked. So it is completely owned by you, right? So in that scenario, you were able to modify, make a change using the browser, which is kind of boring, I would say, you know, very boring, very tedious to change using the browser. It's very hard. If you have a complex file, you want to write some code, changing this in the browser can be challenging. Like, just watch it, new file. You want me to write here? I don't want to. No, I would rather use something like Atom to make edits into a proper editor than use this. So that's what I would like to use. So I have these files here, so YST and all these guys. And that's the kind of structure that I want to actually make use of, and not a browser. So a proper editor is what I would like to use. So I can regulate exactly what I'm dealing with and be very careful and diligent in the changes I'm making to my file structure. And that's why you need to identify the particular fork that you have. So I can identify your fork, which happens to be, okay, where are the forks? So the forks are, I think, here. So here you have Shijatsu, probably one of these. No, that's Giselle. So yeah, let's work on Giselle's. So we have Giselle's pull request. So here Giselle has this patch. So if you go to Giselle's account and look at this, now she created apparently one on her own, and then she's working in this folder called Badal1. So that's the folder that got a -1 appended because apparently she started with her own repository with the same name. So that was the collision that was avoided by creating a Badal-1. When she went here and then clicked the fork button, that's what happened, that we now have a Badal-1. You can see that this is original creation picture and this is a fork picture. This picture itself shows that this is forked out from somewhere. So you click on that one and that shows that it has been forked from. some location. So now Giselle can, what she can do is take a clone. So see that link? If you copy that link, this link is kind of nice, but you will see what it means. Is I'm going to paste it right here. No, not this link. Let me go back to another Atom editor. And I should be able to articulate these links for you so you will understand what I'm talking about. I'm basically talking about, why is it not copying? Okay, copy, cut, copy, cut, and then paste, there. So that was a link that you saw from Giselle's location, and I'll also grab a link from my own location. There are slight differences in the links that I have. Apparently, one of the differences that you will notice is that I seem to like to use SSH protocol as opposed to using HTTPS protocol, which is also available to me, by the way. I just need to change the protocol and then use the HTTPS protocol. So, you know, first two links are basically for the same repository. They're structured differently. One operates through SSH method, this one. The other one operates through HTTPS method. And these two are basically pointing to the same destination, which is Cloud Genius Badal. Cloud Genius Badal. Same idea, same location in the cloud, same location in GitHub, two different methods of accessing. This is with a password. The SSH is with a key without a password. So you need a key pair for that. So the key-based method and the password-based method. Two methods, same idea. Next, what Giselle did here is that she had forked it from this location. So which means she can clone it from this location to her laptop. What does that mean, cloning? Is that she can go back to Giselle location, which is this one. And in this location, there is this HTTPS or SSH2 IDS. We'll use the HTTPS for her. And click that link and basically grab that entire folder structure grabbing the mouse back to Atom Editor. And if you look at this link, which is the same one, she can clone it from this location. Let us try to clone it from Giselle's badal1.git. So we have that link. We'll try to clone it right here in our laptop into this location, into another folder, cd dot dot. So go to the main location, and that's where we'll operate on, and we'll get the Badal 1 from Giselle, this link, which basically means we have to go to this location, Giselle's location, and identify how do I clone. So we want to clone it. So we'll take that link, copy, and then go to our terminal, which is right here. Clear the screen and say git clone paste. What this command will do is get whatever Giselle has. Let's see. And yes, we can read Giselle's repository, but we cannot write to Giselle's repository because it is her repository. She has the permissions to read and write. We don't, so we cannot mess with it. We can already read it. It's a public repository. So I was able to clone it. What did clone do? Basically copied locally. So in our folder, if you look at what do we have, there are two folders. One of them is the Badal folder, and the other one is the Badal 1 folder, which came from Giselle. And so here, she has only one file in that apparent directory, only one, which is what she has. We can go and examine in the Badal 1. What is the git remote? Git remote, it came from Giselle. What is the git log? It came from a fork of Cloud Genius, as you can see. And so that's what we saw. If you go back out into the main Badal group, into the main Badal folder, and say git log, before that git remote, you will see that the git remote is pointing to Cloud Genius. You will see git log. It has a ton of entries right there. These entries basically came from various activities that happened as we were able to operate on the on the tree that we are constructing out of Tinker Toys, if you will, these Tinker Toys, right? 1, 2, 3. Now, let us experiment with a couple of, I would call them a little bit crazy ideas, because that's what they are. So I will do that in a new folder, completely out of it. Make it a little big so you can see some of the craziness, or rather some, you can call it fun, call it crazy, whatever you call it. So let's call it crazy for now. Okay, go create a crazy folder, go inside it, and initialize a new repository right here. So we create git init right here. Now we have those two folders, the only one folder containing a git repository and nothing else. Now we'll create something. So we'll say touch xyz. And we now have a file called xyz and the folder called git.git along with it. Now imagine if I delete the .git folder completely like this. What happens? My file xyz is still there, but my .git folder is gone and my git references are gone. See that? I basically lost my git part of the repository. My file is still there, but my git is gone. So that is what essentially is a place where git stores everything about itself and nowhere else in the computer, only that folder, the .git folder. We can create that git folder one more time very simply by doing this. And so in the crazy folder, we have this file called xyz, and we have the git folder also, which is hidden. Now let us do a couple more crazy things, like adding the content of xyz into the git control. And now we'll see git log. We'll see that we have to commit it before we see the log. So we have to add the we have to commit that git change. So git commit and enter. And here it'll say, what did you do? I added XYZ. And so that's my comment message here. And then I'm going to save it, quit. And then I can check my log, git log. And it says added XYZ. Great. Now I will remove XYZ. And my file is gone. I can bring it back. Something like doing git reset hard. And my file comes back. Right there, XYZ is already there in the listing. Now, a couple more changes. I want to maybe add another file. So say touch ABC. I added another file called ABC. And now this file is not in the git log. So if you say git log, it's still not there. If you say git status, you can find that it contains a reference. This file, I don't know what to do with this file. Do you want to track it? It is untracked. Do you want to track it? So you say git add to track. And so git add ABC to track it, and then we git status to see the status, which is basically now git status shows this new file, but it's not committed yet. You want to commit to it? So you can commit. So say git commit and then enter. And I say I am adding messed up. Hold on. Back up. I am adding ABC, and then save, quit, close. And now we have two commits. So git status, nothing to do. It's all clean, but git log shows you two entries, 1 and 2. And now what we can do is in our folder system, if you see that there are two files, but you know what? I did not intend to actually create ABC. I meant to create PQR, and that's a major mistake. So I want to roll back. Oops, happened, right? This ABC should not have been created because, that was a mistake. I wanted to create PQR or some other file, right? So I want to roll back. I can very simply do that by saying git log. And then I identify these commit tags, this commit hash. And I'll say, you know what? That's the point I want to go back to. So what I'm going to basically do is take that commit hash. This is the identifier, the globally unique identifier. By the way, this is globally unique. So I'm going to take that commit hash from here, and remember it, copy it like this, copied it by Control-Shift-C is break it, Control-Shift-C will copy it. And so that's what I have in the buffer. And you can see it in my buffer when I paste Control-Shift-V to see the buffer. Control-V is not paste, Control-Shift-V is paste. So now I have it in my buffer. What I want to do is, in my folder, I have ABC and XYZ, but ABC is a mistake, grave mistake. I want to go back to how it was before. So what I can do is git checkout and then paste. And now, what do you see? I have just XYZ, no ABC. ABC is gone, like gone. However, it is still there. It doesn't show in the listing because the file was deleted from the folder, but git still has it. Git still has it. Git log. It doesn't show in the log, but if you go git checkout master, and let me check if it's master or head. I'm going to confirm that. Yeah, so we have the file came back. The file ABC came back. If you want to go back to the position before the git log, in the older position time, which is this hash you want to go back to, you can. You can basically do the same thing again, which is git checkout that one, or git checkout master, or head, although those, any of the things you can check out. What does that boil down to? What I just did in the example of the crazy example I'm just showing you is I added XYZ, then I added ABC as a mistake. Oops. Then I reverted that by saying, you know what? I want to go here and check this one out. Check out. So I'm checking out whatever is this Tinker Toy, this commit hash. And these changes between this Tinker Toy and that Tinker Toy need not be small. It can be large changes, and it can be across a forest of Tinker Toys, not just a tree, but a forest of Tinker Toys. And you can jump from any Tinker Toy to another Tinker Toy using this kind of a command. Pretty much like this, git checkout, and you can check out anything that you want across the entire forest, across any branch that you have access to, across any of the tree structure, the forest structure, if you will, and get whatever you want. So like right now, in my folder, I have XYZ. If I say git checkout, and then in my folder, I have ABC also. As simple as that. So you can basically traverse through the state diagram. As I said, these are states, right? Going back to, again, the discussion about it's a graph in computer science, graph, directed graph. So you're basically jumping from one state to the other state as you feel like, any direction up and down, or maybe across, or even further across. There is no limit to it. Every Tinker Toy has a commit hash. The hash kind of sort of looks like this, that long character sequence. That's what it looks like. That's a commit hash. It is globally unique. So this commit hash is globally unique, meaning you cannot collide on the same hash for two different Tinker Toys. So it's exactly one. I mean, that's the machine, that's the state that I'm looking at. So give me that state, that point in time, and back to my laptop right now in my folder where I'm working, maybe this one or some other folder. In that folder, give me my listing, whatever I want, exactly to align with the state that it was at the time this commit hash was taken, and that is globally unique. And so get me that. Here we go. You can get that simply by saying git checkout, and it will get you that. Now, any questions on this idea of jumping around between commit hashes?
Nilesh, I have a quick question.
Yes.
You said globally unique. Is it globally unique within a repository or across repositories?
It's pretty much global, as in the world. Yeah, it's pretty much unique. It's a really long string of characters, so you will probably not see this this colliding. It's fairly long, right? So yeah. it is unique. You can call it globally unique, as in the Git universe.
Okay.
Now the question on difference between checkout and a reset. The reset, basically, if you are dirty, you can clean yourself with a reset. When I say dirty, when you commit, you become clean. Commit is a clean state. You know exactly what you have, and that's what you wanted, and that's what you committed, and that's good. So that's thumbs up. Clean state. Now, after achieving clean state, before you make another commit, you have some things that you created, like ABC created. That is dirty now. So when you have dirty stuff, you want to get back to clean, you reset. And you reset hard, and the variety of things around reset. So you basically go from dirty to clean. That's a reset. Now checkout is And so a checkout can be a traversal between states. So you are currently here, you want to go there, you check that out. You want to go here, you check that out. It is basically whatever was there in the folder at the time the commit was taken. So that's a checkout. I hope that answers your question, right, Alex?
Well, I was just curious because it looked like what you did was you did a checkout to the previous commit, that hash for that commit, but if you're not, ideally, don't you want to reset back to it? Something like, it seemed, I don't know, I always use reset when I want to revert back to a previous
yes. There are multiple ways of doing the same thing, by the way. So you can, so let's see. You have these two git logs, two commit
hashes. Because that commit.
Yes, go ahead.
Yep.
Question?
So no, I guess what my question is, if you check out to the previous commit, then that, if you make a commit and you want to revert to a previous one, if you just check it out, it doesn't get rid of that newer commit.
Correct. Checking out doesn't get rid of the newer. It stays. You see, I'm getting rid of the file ABC, apparently getting rid of. So right now, let's go do it again. So clear. Clear. I have the file, right? It's called ABC and XYZ, two files. Now, if I want to check out, so what I want to check out is, let me just do these two things side by side. So here we go, another one, side by side, and git log. So you have two commit hashes on the right half of the screen. You have two commit hashes, right? So in the status right now is on master. We are on the master branch, which is basically on the top right there. That's what we have. So we can copy that thing and say, you know what, I want to git checkout the master. And it will do nothing. You're already there. And so you still have ABC and XYZ. And if you do git checkout master, you're already having ABC and XYZ. But if you do git checkout and then the original previous item, then you will lose ABC. Lose as in, it'll go away from your folder, but Git still has it. That thing is still intact. It has ABC. This thing does not have ABC. It has the XYZ, and it keeps that. And this, the whole tree is available. You're just not using it right now. The whole thing is available to you, but you are checking out this one. So that's what you're checking out, man. That's what you will see in the folder in the listing is it will be only that thing. So go to the crazy folder here and go to, come on, crazy. That's what you see, XYZ right there. And that XYZ will be visible to you. If you change the go to master checkout. So here we go. The git checkout master. Watch the folder on the right half of the screen. Watch it. ABC will come back. Right? As simple as that. You can go and check out something else. ABC will disappear. And checkout master, ABC will come back. So the folder itself is changing based on what you decide that the folder should contain. And the regulation is happening through git control. Right?
So what's the best practice then?
Sorry?
What's the best practice for that situation? Can you do that hard reset or to do a checkout? So, because like, because if you never want to use AB, yeah.
Yeah, so I understand. So should we do a reset?
Is there a best practice or could you use either one?
Both are legally valid. However, since this is a committed change, it will remain. This I committed, right? Even though it was a mistake, I have committed it. And so it is not just doing a mistake, but committing a mistake is a different idea. It's not the common English language usage of committing a mistake. This is like doing a mistake, creating it, making it wrong thing happen, and then committing that change into Git. That change you have committed, so Git will always have that hash, which means it will always have ABC. Now, what you can do, if you want to not go and deal with ABC because you apparently made a mistake. So XYZ added, and this was, let's call them 8F0 and A20. Okay, 8F0 and A20, the two commit hashes. So this was 8F0. And then you made a mistake, I made a mistake and I added ABC incorrectly. But then not only that, I also have A20 committed it. So this is a commit hash. So since I have committed it, I just have to live with it. It is there, going to be there for me forever because I made a commit. Now, if I don't want to use it, what I can do is go back here through a git checkout and then call this my main tree. And that's okay. And I can just keep on working. And at some point, I can just erase this out of my memory. So that can go away. And then my main becomes this. That is totally okay. At any time you feel that you committed a mistake, and not just committed a mistake, but made a mistake and added it to a git commit, then you don't want it, you go a step back and then roll forward from there in a different direction. That becomes your main. And this becomes your master. And that's how
Basically you just end up having a leaf that you don't ever visit, I guess.
Correct. And you can even discard the leaf, actually. You can create a branch out of it, kill the branch and, you know, kill it out completely. That's also okay. But you know what? Nobody cares. You don't need to worry about it because your main route becomes this. So you just change your route. It's like you're driving a car in an African safari and you hit a mud pot. You just drive around it, right? That's what happened.
Yeah.
So you just drive around, your route becomes different, but then that's the main route. Bingo. Keep moving. Our goal is to not have a straight line, but to have a goal accomplished, right? It doesn't need to be a straight line. It's a graph. It's a flexible thing. You can change it around the way you like. It's just a directed graph. I mean, it's a conceptual thing. There's no straight lines here. It's just a concept. And there are no lines, actually. It's just commits, right? These hashes. That's what we have. There is no line here. So, yes, a stray leaf might be left behind with a mistake, but who cares? Move on. That's the easy way out. Now, if you'd really be disciplined about cleaning stuff, I would suggest not, because it's a waste of time. Why do you care about a leaf sitting on the side? Oof. That's how I think. Now, some people may disagree, but that's okay. Next question. Okay, no questions. That's awesome. So let us do then next one, which is
No, wait. I'm sorry, Nilesh. Could you please resend the invitation to the group for me? Because I didn't get it the first time. Okay. I didn't have my notification set up correctly.
No worries. So now I will go to the Cloud Genius group and team and the Badal team. And the name you have is Rebecca, right?
No, this is Helen.
Oh, sorry. Helen.
That's okay. Everybody does that.
Sorry. I was not even looking at the GoToMeeting. I could have told who's the active speaker, but so I have
no problem.
Helen and Giselle both pending invitations. So I'm going to invite both of you one at a time. Once again, invitation already sent. There we go.
Hey, Nilesh, mm-hmm. It's top of the hour. Is this a good place?
Yes, it is. Yeah.
Let my brain rest just a minute.
So 7:02, let's get together at 7:05. Until that time, we'll deal with these invitation businesses and making sure people are actually receiving the invitations and all that good stuff. So just administration stuff, we'll do that. We'll not talk technology. And there we go. So apparently...
Hey, Nilesh.
Yes.
Nilesh?
Yes.
Sorry, I need you to help me because I don't want to get pined and I am not getting where you are. So is there any way you can help me during the break?
Yes. So active speaker was... who was the active
This
speaker?
Is Rebecca. Sorry.
Why is the active speaker name not showing?
Okay. Can I share my desktop and I'll show you what's where I'm at? And
Rebecca, I am going to make you a presenter. And there we go. So go ahead, please.
Thank you.
And in the meanwhile, on the side, I will invite Helen again. It says Helen invitation sent already. And I'm going to send it one more time.
I'm just not getting it.
Helen.
So he's doing two things at once, Rebecca. He's sending me an invitation so I can join the group.
And then Rebecca can then present her screen. And
Nilesh, can I check mine as well? I'm not sure if I got it.
Yeah, I will. I will do that. That was Deepak Ramesh 26. Invited. Helen invited. Giselle invited. And Rebecca presenting her screen.
Mm-hmm.
Awesome. So let's go look at your screen and let's understand what's going on.
Okay. So I've created several files and I just don't know what I'm supposed to be doing at this point.
Yes, I can
see. So I've created the files.
You have created an.txt, zz.txt, and now you have to create a pull request. And there is a green colored button in the middle of the page to create a pull request. And so you have made changes. The next logical thing for you to do is to request me to pull your changes.
That's why I don't know what to do. Yes, so how do I do that?
Click on
new
that.
Pull request?
Yeah, click on that. New pull request.
Okay.
And then request me to pull it. That's it. So create pull request. That's all it is. So there is a green button to create a pull request.
Right. I'm just trying to figure out what it is that it's doing. So it's
So here you're saying that, Nilesh, can you please pull these two files? That's all that it is. So you just say, you know, Nilesh, can you please take these two files and say...
So the title is just a comment?
It's a request title. So title
for
the request.
Okay.
And then in the body, you can leave a comment about the request itself.
Whoops.
Or that's okay. Right. That's totally fine. Totally fine. So you have Nilesh, please pull my files. And so you have generated a new pull request for me. Now what I'll do on my side is I'm going to show you my screen and then show my screen, go back to repositories and identify your pull request. And there is the pull request from Rebecca. And we are going to look at the files themselves. And so you have a file. The file name is an.txt, which does not meet our convention.
Oh, I just wanted one letter, but I couldn't tell what was taken.
That's okay. But, you know, the idea is we have your pull request. And so the idea succeeded. Yes, we can either merge the pull request or say that, you know what, sorry, the convention is to have a single letter for every character in the alphabet. and so it does not match the match the.
How would I how would I see what all files are? Sorry, I'm really tired.
I know. What you're asking is what is already checked. How do you see? You go to Badoo.
How do I see what files are checked in already?
Yeah, go to Cloud Genius Badoo and see the listing.
Oh, okay. Then wow, I don't understand why I don't see that when I go to Cloud Genius Badoo. So let me try that again.
Okay, requesting your screen again. I'd ask you to send your screen, share your screen, please.
Yeah, there we go. I don't know why I wasn't seeing it before. It's showing it now.
No worries.
Okay.
It may be a refresh issue.
Okay, that is all I needed. Thank you so much.
So Super Bowl, who's going to watch it? Or rather, who's going to not watch it?
I'm not going to watch it.
I was going to say, is that a trick question?
Why would I waste a perfectly good Sunday watching people have head injuries? I can't hardly watch it just for that. Ugh.
That's right.
You don't watch it for the head injuries. You watch it for the commercials.
Commercials I may just watch on YouTube later.
Yeah, no kidding. Not blow 4 hours. Yeah.
Oh, and then the rest of the time you just eat. You eat snacks, you see. You watch the commercials, and then between the commercials you eat snacks. That's the idea.
Right. Just don't watch the it just makes me too nervous for those young men out there that are just setting up themselves up for a very, very long older age experience.
They're making millions of dollars.
Yeah,
I still can't justify it.
Yeah, you just don't like football, and you're just happy to have a moral excuse. I recognize that.
but I actually prepared today for a different conversation. So Top Gear now has Matt LeBlanc as one of its hosts.
Matt LeBlanc? Really?
Yeah. That's how they're going to make it.
About what is he doing, Matt? I missed that.
So you know Top Gear, right? They fired the main guy on Top Gear, and basically the whole show went away. And so now they're recreating the show, and they have this Chris Evans as the primary host. But who knows Chris Evans? A few people in England know him, but I guess Matt LeBlanc, of course, comes from Friends and all that. So now he's one of the hosts.
Is this you're talking about?
Yep, that's what he's talking about.
Okay.
Yeah, do you know who he is, Nilesh? Matt LeBlanc?
Pardon?
Nilesh, do you know who he is, Matt LeBlanc?
No, not really.
Yeah, I wouldn't think so. He's an old TV superstar from a show called Friends that was on about 20 years ago.
So Friends,
25. It was 90, the 90s. He was Joey on Friends.
Okay, Joey, I know, but I cannot see Joey here.
He's 25 aged. Years older. He's in the black jacket there.
The middle one or the first one?
No,
that guy right, the first one.
Oh, this guy is Joey?
Yeah, that's Joey.
I know
that's
Joey.
Joey in his 50s.
Yeah, that's Joey.
This is Joey, right?
See?
No, that's Ross.
Yeah, Joey's
in this. Okay, this is Joey.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, the guy at the top center, he's the guy that put baby powder all over his leather pants.
Yes.
I did not realize that. So
yeah, that's Ross.
Oh, nice.
Got stuck with the leather pants. So, Nilesh, I still can't join Be a Cloud Genius, but all. Or Badoo. I have the blue dot, but when I click on the blue dot, there's nothing in there.
Okay, let's see if we can get to the
email.
Can you share your desktop, Helen?
No, I can't, but Nilesh can let me share it.
So who wants to share the desktop again?
I want Helen, because I want to see what she's trying to connect to, because I probably can't do it either.
So I think you can.
I think you're a member. I'm not, though.
Oh,
should I make Helen a presenter?
Yep, make me a presenter.
Okay, did that.
All right.
Wait, I just turned on the debate. Larry David's really going at it with Hillary.
Larry David, yes, exactly.
From day one, you're mine.
Luckily to actually see two candidates actually debating issues instead of just calling each other names.
Yeah, for the most part, I tend to be right of center, but you're right on that point. Trump's got to go. He's just an idiot. Whatever. Narcissistic.
So this is Helen going to present right now. Waiting to view Helen's screen. So, Helen, are you having a technical difficulty in presenting, or should we take it back? Okay, I'm taking it back.
I think we may have lost her.
Probably. So I'm taking the screen back, showing my screen, and let us see what Helen... Yeah, we lost her, apparently. She's offline. Helen is showing offline. She'll come back online.
Yeah, It's been a really, really long day for both of us. So.
I can understand. So I think we have let me close out this very, very basic stuff we did with Git. You can do a ton more things. I'm just saying that it is very capable. We're just barely scratching the surface of what it can do. So I'm going to summarize what we have done and move to the next topic, because that's the extent or depth of information or knowledge we need to use Git. Just barely scratching the surface. There is a ton more to learn on your own. The key summary is it allows us to preserve states among various points in time of commits. That's the key thing. You commit, you can go backward, forward if you like. People can collaborate by forking or creating their own branches in the team. So variety of ways to approach. Clone the whole thing, go completely isolated and away. Fork it, keep a relationship with the original, and branch meaning be a part of the team. So three ways to break it from the mainstream, and then you keep changing. So distributed change control, that's what essentially it is, distributed change control. For those of us who have been using control or code control, from a previous generation of tool sets such as SVN or Mercury or other tools, the Git tool set is primarily a distributed change as opposed to centrally controlled change. It's called SVN or Subversion. Some of you may have heard of or used this tool set before. Others in Microsoft may have used this thing called, what's it called? The internal name for it.
Yes, I think.
Huh?
It's called VFS.
Sorry?
TFS.
Yeah. TFS.
TFS is the new name, but it's the internal tool that we used to have. What is it?
It's VSS. VSS.
Visual Source Safe. That's the outside name. There is an internal tool that's where Windows source code is kept. What is that thing called? I forgot the name. Source Depot. Right. That's the name, the internal tool Microsoft has, which is again a very similar thing. But these tool sets like, you know, TFS and Source Depot and Subversion all are kind of create a central point of deadlock.
Have you heard of a one called RCS?
No, but I will find out.
Oh, interesting. Okay.
Now, who's the company behind it?
Oh, it's on any, you can get it for any Unix operating system.
Yeah, it's a really, 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 really old Unix revision.
Oh, this one. I see. Well. Yeah. I never used it. So that's
Pretty nice, actually. It reminds me a lot of Git, but without the GUI interface.
I hate GUI interfaces.
But it has a centrally controlled repository, not distributed.
That's true, yeah.
I see. So Git is distributed. That's a big thing about it is, you know, disconnected people can work on their own without locking, creating a deadlock, and keep moving. So we'll use Git to manage our own folder, our own contents in the folder, occasionally pull something from somewhere or clone something from somewhere and use it. That's our primary clone. That's our primary usage will be going forward, at least in, and sometimes we'll do commits. Sometimes we'll do revision history, git logs, and make sure that we are able to barely use something using Git. That's our extent of coverage of Git in this program. Git can go beyond it, way, way beyond, but we'll use probably scratch the surface of it only, I think so. Now, having said that, we can safely assume that we can at least do some rudimentary operations using this command line tool, terminal, that you probably already know now, that you can pull and you can do commits and pushes and things like that. So we'll be able to do some of that activity right here, right now. Now, let us look at a couple of things, which is our overall schedule. And with that schedule, I have a couple of questions for you. So I think if I'm not mistaken, today is class number 8. Is that right?
Yes.
Yes. Which means we have 8 classes for DevOps and 8 class sessions for architecture. And we have a lot more to cover here. And so it might flow into here. If you don't want it to flow, that is okay. But what I would then suggest is do some of it on your own. Are you okay with that idea? I have it written down in nice, detailed, and hope usable fashion and in this location. So you can go there and find it. And it is written down in a systematic step-by-step approach. I can maybe give you exact location what I'm talking about so you will have an idea. And so I'm logging in right now. Why can't I log in? Okay, there we go. So I'm logging in, and then at this moment, I should be able to go and see the content on the site, which is in dashboard, cloud technologies, and then go identify the one, this one, module 15. So that is where it begins. And there is a long and apparently a heavy copy and paste exercise, mostly copy paste. So you copy from the site and paste it in the terminal and you see things happening. That's what that exercise is, mostly copy and paste. And I'm saying it copy and paste, but you know, maybe I'm exaggerating. Maybe it is not just copy and paste. It begins at that point, which I'm just saying on the Slack chat. That's where it begins. Now, what that exercise essentially does, let us go look at it. That exercise is creating an application and using it with a platform as a service called Heroku. And so what I intend to do is not do that exercise right here, unless you want it. If you need an extra session, I have no problem doing that. It's your call. You need to tell me and decide. Rather, decide and tell me, and we can discuss that. But the bottom line is, the two key things I want you to take away is to have an application created, put that inside a Git commit, and then that application uses Ruby language. And then once we have the application ready, we'll run it here, run locally on the laptop. And then once we feel happy about it, then we send it, basically push, Git push, to Heroku. And then it will run in Heroku as opposed to locally, it will run here. And when you have these steps taken, that's what you're basically doing is as an app developer, you develop some application. You all along as you develop the application, you put things in a Git repository, so Git commits flow, and you create the Tinker Toy sequence. And so you have a repository containing multiple items as you go checking them in, committing them in, and then you have, at some point, your application runs locally. That's half of that step sequence that you see here in this that you're looking at. So half of it is basically creating the application itself. And at some point, you will verify that your app runs locally. And so that's what you will do in this step. Now, having done that part, the next step is to take this git commit here, this commit hash, and say, you know what, git push it to Heroku, send it over. So who is Heroku? That is what a platform as a service is. And so the idea that I have heard, at least some of you in the program told me, that you already have done this kind of work, which is nice, but not everybody. So that's a trade-off that I want to understand. Is I want you to get some of the solid ideas from a usage perspective. We have had, you know, if you look at the technologies program, it is broadly in three parts. The software as a service part is kind of trivial, so we'll ignore that. I call it trivial. It can be trivial, actually. This part, we went in depth. And I want to focus here. That the customer of this platform as a service essentially is a developer of an application. They have to develop an app. So if you want to use a PaaS, you need to become a developer or at least have an app. And so to have an app, then you can then give it to the platform and say, hey, take it and run it. And so that's an example. That's the example that you have here in the sequence that I just pasted in Slack chat. Now, the question I have for you is, what do you want to accomplish in the session today? If you think you want to do this exercise on your own and have a separate session later, I am okay with that. If you think we want to run the program and the session sequence right now at a rapid pace so you have a clear understanding of what am I doing, and then you do it on your own and still need a separate session, I'm still okay with that. If you want me to go slow and help you understand, go ahead.
One of the questions would be, if we did this one on our own, what would you be covering instead today?
So the thing that I really want to cover is to build a PaaS, which is more of this side. It is complex, and it is also written down.
Yeah, I think.
But that.
Yeah, I would say if whatever is more complex and harder to conceptually understand, you'd probably want to go more in depth with, because at least from what you're saying is that part where you deploy the app on Heroku, it's kind of laid out line by line by line. It's a copy paste exercise that people can go and do and then ask questions about in order for you to fill in any, you know, little gaps that they might need you to fill in, and you're always available from what I've seen, so it wouldn't be too bad for waiting for you to help.
Yeah, let's just go on with build an app, PaaS.
Okay.
I agree.
Okay. So if that is the consensus, I would suggest that here is the next homework assignment right now. The assignment is very, very trivial. It's a copy and paste thing, but just do it. Because doing it is actually understanding what does it take to develop an app and put it on a platform as a service that is commercially available. And we'll use this Heroku example. Heroku is a Japanese word for something I don't know. It is owned by Salesforce.com. Okay. Now, Salesforce.com basically bought them, I think, Heroku, and they have this as a platform available here. And so you go to Heroku.com, sign up, and here, the bottom line is, JavaScript, Ruby, what is this? I don't know what this thing is, but PHP, Python, Go, something else, and something else, some random languages, new languages apparently. So this is Java, huh? Okay, JV is Java Virtual Machine based. Okay, I could not identify the picture itself, but the idea is all these languages supported. So you bring your app in that language of choice. And then you focus on your application to work, make it work on your laptop. And then when you have it done, then you basically say, push it to Heroku, and it runs there away from you in a real life. An example is this. So there is an app for that that I have created, and then I have pushed it, and it looks like this. So just an example, right? So it's just a site. Another example, this example, you have seen it already. This is a place where you can invite yourself to Slack chat, and that is an app. It is running on another platform as a service called Red Hat. What's the name of that? The exact name, I think, is OpenShift. So just like Heroku is a platform as a service, you have OpenShift is another platform as a service available from Red Hat. So that is exactly what is going on right now. If you go to the web console, you will see that this OpenShift is running this chat service for me here, like that. And what I have done is written this application in JavaScript using IOJS, and I have pushed it. How does it work? It works pretty much like this in like few lines. I can show you. I have internal code that I will pass if you like. And what is it called? Slackin? So here's the code. Like pretty much that's what I do. Or maybe I begin from, for setup, it requires all the way from top. For a redeploy, it requires only these steps. So few steps and you have a new app running. The app is already prepared and stored in a Git repository. So all I need to do is take the app and say, push. And when I say push to OpenShift, the app goes live and sits here. And that's what you see. So here you can invite yourself like this. And you can check your email. And so you can go check your email. And there should be an invitation like this. So you join the team and there you go. So that's the app. It's very simple, very trivial. But the idea essentially is you write an app and then you give it to some platform. So I wrote that IOJS based app for Slack. And then this I pushed to OpenShift. And then it runs there. And it runs like this. That's it. That's the whole concept behind it. So I would like you to take an app, or rather build one. And so the exercise that you have here actually describes you how to build the app and all that. And there will be some questions about, you know, the rudimentary questions such as what is going on in SSH key? How do you add that? There is this question about MVC. Some people may be not familiar with this idea, so they will get this clarity from here. And some of us will have this question about Ruby in general. What the heck is going on? Why this gem file and all that? So those questions will come. So you will have these questions. And for those of us that are new to developing apps, I offer to have another session focused just on this exercise about Heroku. I will do that with you guys if you want. And so I think it's a good idea to just have a session for optional session. You don't have to attend. But if you want to cover this Heroku business, I offer another session just to cover that base. But right now, I want to continue to the next step, which is this one, building a pass. And it is complex. So you have to, it's more like an infrastructure exercise because you're actually building a pass on top of an infrastructure. So that is going to be involved. So anything as you go towards this direction becomes difficult. This direction, it is easier to do. SaaS is super easy. Platform is somewhere in between. Dealing with hardware infrastructure is kind of complex and kludgy, and you don't see anything, you don't touch anything, but you still have to deal with it. Those kind of issues come along. So it becomes harder to comprehend, harder to understand, harder to actually build something out. But this step, I propose that you please give me a date and let us have a session to make sure that all of us who need help are taken care of from this, who are new to development, especially those folks. I want to address them and make sure that I dedicate some time for you to go through the Heroku exercise. So please offer a time, optional, and any time you can pick, as long as it is not Tuesday, Thursday, and Saturday in the evening and Saturday morning. Don't collide with an existing session. Pick any other time and tell me, and we move to the next step.
Probably we should take that offline and then...
Offline. So please offer chat suggestions and let's do that. Let's move on to the next one, okay. Which is what we are going to do next is that we are going to jump on to this idea. And that is going to be deploying your own platform on top of infrastructure. So there is going to be some infrastructure we need, and we are going to build our own platform. This basically means we are building Heroku, or we are building OpenShift. We are building OpenShift for ourselves. We are building Heroku for ourselves. That's a complex exercise. Just realize that. That's what we are doing. And we will do that using an open source product. Open source product is called this. That's what we'll be using. There are a variety of different open source platforms available that we can use. This is one of them. There are many others. Here is another one. So Flynn is another example. Another one is from Cloud Foundry, EMC guys. And so here is Cloud Foundry open source platform as a service. And you can take DEES, or DEES as they call it, DEES, or Flynn, or Cloud Foundry, and create your own Heroku or OpenShift.
Cloud Foundry is what we're actually looking to use in our cloud.
Yes. And that is a fairly elaborate, very exhaustive and time-consuming deployment. And that's why we're not doing it in the classroom. But this is the leader in the space, by the way. In the open source space, this is the leader. It is very well supported by the industry and by the community. And it is people like IBM, Pivotal, HP, VMware, all the big names, you have them behind you. If you, excuse me, if you decide to use Cloud Foundry, that is recommended approach. Although it is very involved as an exercise to take it as a classroom example. That is why we don't have it. We have something that is actually doable in a session. So that's why we have chosen a simpler example, which has documentation available, the source code is available, and all that good stuff. You can basically take, the Flynn or Deez or Cloud Foundry, any of these guys. There are many more like that, by the way. But the good idea behind all these things is that you can take this application package and put that on top of any cloud you like Amazon or Bare Metal Cloud or DigitalOcean Cloud or Google Cloud or Linode or Microsoft Azure or OpenStack or Vagrant or whatever. So basically take this thing, put it on top of some hardware and put this on top, and that will make your platform as a service for you, which means you need something at the foundation, right? So we'll use one of the infrastructure as a services service. And then take the source code, put it right here, and then we will have it working. That's our goal. And have it working as in what? We'll get a platform. And then on that platform, we'll do exactly what we are doing in the other exercise, which is we are taking an app, putting it in a Git commit, running it locally, and then pushing it not to Heroku, but our own pass. That's the difference. There is no Heroku involved. There is no OpenShift involved, but we'll do the same thing. Our goal is take the source code, open source, put it on top of infrastructure as a service to create our own platform as a service, then take some app and put it right here, and then make it run in the cloud. That's our goal, and I hope we can do that in the next hour and a half. Okay, we have enough time. So I think we can do it. Now, what I will do is put 50-50 screen on side by side so you can watch what I'm doing. Avoid attempting to do this along with me because there are lots and lots of little things needed to make it happen, make it complete. So avoid that part and instead focus on getting to a point where we can get this completed, at least in my computer. You can watch the video later on and repeat that exercise on your own, but be careful in watching what we are doing. So that's the most important thing. I'm going to go back to something that makes my life a little easier, which is a terminal on this half and a terminal on this half and terminal, please, terminal, and put it that half. Adjust the screen a little bit. There we go. And go back here, close out unnecessary windows. Okay. And close, close. So it is important for me to articulate the underlying thinking and concepts, not just copy paste. And that's what I will attempt to do. So first goal.
Nilish, could you please give us the URL for that? Because I've been looking for that and I can't find it.
Okay, here we go. You got that, right? Avoid attempting this exercise. First, you do the Heroku one. You get familiar with it. Propose a time. We can do a separate session on it. And then you come to this exercise. Do not attempt this one first. Not scaring you, but just saying. Okay, so first thing, we have to get the source code, right? From somewhere. The source code is available on GitHub, and it is on the company that makes it. And I typed the name wrong. That's the company, the team of people that makes it. It's not a company, it's just a team. And this team is called the DAIS project. The project itself is available here. And it was updated a day ago, meaning it is fresh. And it is, you know, most open source projects change over time, like quite rapidly. So the source code is available in that location. DAIS, which is exactly where we will go and grab it from, right there. So git clone. And then we will set up some keys. We'll get a fingerprint, send that fingerprint over to DigitalOcean. So we'll take an infrastructure as a service provider. In our example, we'll be using DigitalOcean. And then follow along with some steps to create a discovery URL, run Terraform. If that is not installed, we'll install it. And then edit our path, refresh our terminal, and then create a place to run Docker containers where DAIS will run the apps. Then we have to do some DNS trickery. This is the hard part, DNS changes. And some exotic changes we have to do that will look eventually like this in the picture. And then you have to test and validate the DNS before proceeding forward. So we'll do that part. And then install some binaries from DAIS and install a couple more binaries from DAIS. Then enable keyless login with our own pass. By the way, at this time, we have our pass ready. Then we enable keyless login. We set up a tunnel to operate with DAIS. Then we install and start our platform. At this point, our pass is running. We should be able to see the results. And then we check its version. Then we will install a client application to operate with DAIS. Then we use the client application itself, send our keys this time to the platform as a service, our own platform, get a sample application, and establish remote links, and then push it to this, and then open it up to see your app, scale the app, as in grow the size of the number of containers it runs in, and then you destroy. That's the step. Yes, it is daunting, but never mind. And so what I want to do is make sure that I don't confuse you, which I just remembered, is to not use this terminal, but instead use the terminal from here instead of adding to confusion. So cut that, keep it in this workstation so you are not confused about how the terminal looks different and why is it different and all that. So begin. We are getting a clone from the Deez repository. So copy, and let us see if the Deez already exist. Probably not. Okay, that's good. That's good. We don't have it. That is nice. So we'll paste it from the left side to the right side. That's a copy and paste, simple. And then we'll clone it. This clone is a big package. So it takes a little bit of time to clone the whole thing down. This is cloning. It finished, which means we have a folder called Deez already in our location. So we'll go inside it. And then we are doing a checkout. This Deez, if you go look at log, or the git log of that, it will have a ton of different commits, right? You can see them, all these. They go on and on and on and on for all the activity that the team is doing to build it up. It'll go on and on. But we don't know what the team did yesterday. We don't know what the team did the day before yesterday or 6 days ago. They are committing every day, 9 days ago, 6 days ago, 5 days ago, 2 days ago. Something is changing all the time. And I do not want to waste your time. So what I have done is identified a particular commit that we know works. And so we are going to check that one out, as opposed to dealing with what we have right now in this folder. We want to work on that tag. 1101 tag is what I want to check out. So I will, like this, and I have it. So now my content of the folder is what I want to have, as opposed to what this team wanted to give me yesterday. And so I changed my timestamp or my pointer reference in my git commit hash to a point in time which I want, as opposed to a point in time what they want to give me. My hash is 5 echo 004 delta echo, as opposed to the hash right now is 112 foxtrot 513. That hash is the one that they have a day ago, which is not the hash I want. I want this one. So I got that one. That's the hash. That's what I'm working with right now, because I know it works. I know it works. There are other things might also work, but I don't know yet. I have to experiment with it, but then I don't want to waste your time. So I'm going to a thing that I know works. And this one is that one of them. So I check it out. Next, I want to set up some keys. How do I do that? I want to create a specific key for Deez, Deez. So I will use this command to generate a key pair. Do I already have it in my SSH folder? Let us see. Do I have the keys called Deez in my SSH folder? No. So I need to come out, go back to Deez folder. Oh, not here. Deez folder. And in that folder, I will run this command to generate the keys. The command itself will generate a key pair and put it in the .ssh folder, just like all other keys go there. This key will also go to the same location and be sitting there for us. Boom. And it did. So we can go and check it. And here you will find that the key called Deez is created right there, Deez and Deez.pub. You got two new keys. It's a key pair. It's a private-public combination, different from our existing keys. These keys are to be used with everything else. These keys are to be used with Day's project. That's what we'll be doing right now. So we created a new key pair, and that's what we have. So we have generated this key pair. Next step is to generate a fingerprint for the Days.pub. This pub, you have to create a fingerprint. How do you do that? This line. So you generate a fingerprint like that. It's a copy and paste again, but what we are essentially doing is generating a fingerprint based on the key that we have, Days.pub, right there. Now we have the key fingerprint that looks like this. So I want to have that in my buffer. So I'll Control Shift C copy, and then take the next logical step that we want to give to DigitalOcean. That's the key company, right? So you want to make sure that you have the hash of the public key, which is this one, this key hash that we generated. And we will use this fingerprint as a reference with the cloud IaaS provider in a subsequent step. So subsequent step, we will use the DigitalOcean cloud. We'll log in. And in that cloud, we do not have anything. We have basically deleted most of the things we had in there. And I will make sure to make it all clean, remove all the keys and everything. So where are my keys? Security. And the key that I have is the SSH ID RSA. So this one we have there. So we don't need to delete that one. But then I need to add the other key. So I will do that. Just like it says here, cat the public key and paste into DigitalOcean. So that's what we are going to do, is the cat the public key like this. And take the whole content of it, copy, Control Shift C. Shift C, not the without shift. If you don't use shift, it will break it. You don't want that. You want to copy. So take the copy, go to DigitalOcean, add a key, and call it DEIS, and paste, and then create. Now you will notice that the fingerprint of this DEIS key here matches what we have here, like that. So it matches. So it's the fingerprint of the key showing up right here. That's what we want to use for this exercise, is a different key. So we have it here. This is the fingerprint. This is the key itself, the public key, and the private key is hidden. It is safe. It is private only for my usage, and I never share it with anybody. So that's the understanding. Now with next one, what we have to do is paste the public key into DigitalOcean, which we did, and cross-check the fingerprint that might look something like this. So we did that. The cross-check succeeded. Next, what we need to do is to create a token, API token from DigitalOcean. Now what this token business is, let us see. You recall we did some, in case of Amazon Web Services, we had a key, name was different, access key ID and secret access key. This was created for, I think some of you, I created that for you. You may have created it for your own. And this is tied to the account. This is tied to your credit card. It means money. So that's what we did for this cloud. We are doing the same thing for a different cloud called DigitalOcean, but instead of two things, one and two, they just have only a token, one large token. So large token. So there'll be a token, and this token is tied to your credit card. It means money. So keep it safe. Don't share, which means I will generate a token in DigitalOcean right here and go to API. Remember, it's in the API. And by the way, some of you may not have an account with DigitalOcean, so you can create one using this reference. Go to the free accounts, and in there you will find DigitalOcean, and there is this coupon for $10. So that's where you will find it. This referral link will get you $10 in your account. So use that. That $10 is enough for any kind of trial for about a month or two or something like that. So make sure you go through the coupon so you get some free stuff back here. So we have to generate a token, right? A token is basically giving you access to the account without having to type a password. So we generate a token and we call it DES or DACE and make sure we are giving it read permissions as well as write permissions. Both permissions are given. So DACE token, create. So we got a token there. We got to copy it. And I just showed this token to all of you and is also getting recorded, which means I need to delete this token as soon as I can, as soon as the exercise is finished, which means I need to save this token here, which I did, and then continue. So I have the token that looks like long string of characters. Save it. You will use it later. Okay, I've saved it. I need to make a discovery URL. Now, what is this thing, a discovery URL? So let us understand this aspect. What is going on under the covers is that this DACE thing will generate a bunch of machines in your DigitalOcean cloud and then put in a place where it will run containers, not VMs. It will run containers inside those machines. We'll have one, two, and three probably. So three machines we'll get from DigitalOcean, and in there we'll run Docker containers. Inside those Docker containers, these containers need to identify who this guy is and who's that guy is, and maybe more containers. So those containers need to identify each other. They need to discover each other. This discovery happens through a method from a centralized service, which is a part of core OS. That is the OS that we will be using on the machines right here. And so this core OS discovery method, they have a specific method to generate a discovery URL. And that URL we need to provide to all these containers so that they can discover each other. That's the summary idea behind discovery URL. And so we have to create one, make discovery URL, and we will create that. So we have in the DES folder, make discovery URL. And it generates a new URL for us to use. You can see that the URL is this. And that's the URL that we have saved in a file called contrib core OS user data. That file got saved. You can see that file right now. Contrib. What was the name again? Contrib core OS user data. Okay, contrib core OS user data. This entire file got created, and in that file is embedded the discovery URL somewhere down below. Let me get the discovery URL again. It is
it's in the top section.
Okay, 45751. Okay, top section. I'll go to the top. And somebody found it. There it is. The discovery URL showed up right there. So that discovery URL along with this whole file got created. And now this code knows how to discover. Based on the URL, it'll go and ping it and find out who else is using the same, and that's how they will discover each other. That's the idea behind this discovery URL concept. That file user data just got created, by the way. You can see that our repository that did not have it before. Here, contrib core OS. It just has the user data example. But it does not have the user data itself. So this example exists, and it does not have the discovery URL. Hashtag discovery URL is missing in the example. But in the real file, the hashtag discovery URL has been replaced by the real value of the URL itself, which is this value. Wrote that value to contrib Coreos user data. That file got created with this exact value that we need for the discovery URL itself. I hope this is clear. This is probably a little bit confusing as to what discovery URL is, but this is basically a pointer which every container will go and look for other brothers and sisters and then connect to them. So it's a method of discovering what other containers do I have at my disposal for me to run my application as I scale them out. Remember scaling out. So that's what we will do. And right now, to scale out, we need to be able to have each container know its brother or sister. And that discovery of where is my brother, where is my sister, needs to be possible and feasible. And that will not happen if you don't have a method, a systematic method of discovering who are my brothers and sisters in my cluster. And so when you have that, this method will be used to find out brethren and then spawn or create or scale out processes as and when we need to. Hope that is clear. If there is a question, go ahead and stop me. Next one is to accommodate a bug that we have seen. The bug is right in this code right now. We have checked out something, but then I have found a bug in that particular 1.10.1. It doesn't seem to work without this particular checkout. And that's why we are going to check out one more time. Accommodate an issue that has recently cropped up in days, which means one more checkout. So here we go. Check it out. It includes a pull request from Ben for something. So we'll discuss that later as to what that exact change is. But somebody requested a pull request and sent in a change, and that was taken and all that. So we're looking at that one. Now that pull request has been incorporated in our checkout, so we are happy. Now we need to check whether we have a form, a tool to generate a new blueprint, right? You remember me referring to this idea of designing your infrastructure as a service and, creating out a nice little blueprint, and then you want to copy the whole thing. And I think Patrick asked me this question: how do I automate this thing over? How do I copy and paste my cloud? Right? You remember that? And so you can, create a VPC and all that, all the complexity associated with route tables and subnets and everything and machines and all that good stuff. And you want to copy the whole thing, you can. Paste it here, yes, you can. You can use a tool called CloudFront. But then that will marry you to Amazon Web Services, and we don't like that. I don't want to get married to any company. So this CloudFront, I don't care. I care about something that is open. Terraform is open. And that is the tool we'll be using. I mentioned this tool a while ago. I think I remember. If I'm mistaken, I'm sorry. But Terraform is the tool that we'll be using right now, and it is on GitHub, and it is installed on the laptop already. You have it already. If not, we'll check it. So check whether you have it. Run this command. Do I have it? Yes, you do. It is out of date, but don't worry. Don't worry. This out of date also works. So don't rush into updating it. Make sure that it works the way you want as is, and then you can explore and understand, what does it mean to update and all that. So you can follow the stream first, get it to work, and then in the next attempt, you make changes. There's nothing wrong in experimenting, but succeeding at the very first attempt gives you pleasure. So get that pleasure of success by following the stream. And then you go deviate. Okay, the 6.6 old version, I want to get a newer version, fine. But do that in the second attempt. Not right now. And do only one change at a time. Remember, this is an important way of thinking, by the way. So the important change, the thinking that I am digressing a little bit, but what I'm telling you is a critical way of thinking. How you think. there is a flow here, right? Some flow, some random flow. Some random flow. That seems to work, apparently. And you want to go to a different route. Nothing wrong. Great idea. Go do that. But when you are thinking about a deviation, it is important to make only one change at a time. This is important. Only one change at a time. You make only one change, tiny little change, and see if everything is still okay. And if it is okay, you lock it. You make a git commit. Git commit right there. You make a change, you make a commit. Because now you know it works, and then you proceed to the next one change at the second time. Then you are deviating again. And that's beautiful. But then don't do two changes at one time, because you will have no idea which one works, which one doesn't. And that is the way of thinking. Is one change at a time. Small is good. Big is bad. You can do lots of small things, one after the other, to make you successful faster. If you change too many things at the same time, you will have no idea what messed up. You cannot figure it out. If you're doing only one change at a time, you can tell exactly whether the change worked or it did not. It's very black and white. And if it doesn't work, you can roll back and proceed in a different direction. So if this doesn't work, okay, no worries. I go this way. But if you do two changes, this and this, and you have no idea where to go now, so you're basically wasted your time. You have to go back here. And that's the way of thinking that I'm advocating, is do only one change at a time. Small changes are good. Okay, back here. Terraform, already installed. Do not update the very first time. Update it the next time, and that's a change. So do that just one change and then see if it works, and then proceed to do any other change you may want to do. So that's the next thing. Now Terraform is already there. Great. If it is not installed, then this is how you install, by the way. So you have it. Okay, fine. The next thing is, if you're installing it yourself, then you need to edit this file to include Terraform in the path. If you don't do it, then this Terraform will not work without this step. So you open the editor and then add this line. And then when you add this line, then you save and quit, and then refresh the terminal, and then you refresh the terminal, or you can just exec $shell, and then you go back to the days folder. And that's how you update Terraform. I am not updating Terraform right now, not at all. I'm going to skip all these steps. Not doing it, this is good enough for now. Out of date, fine. I'm going to use it as is. But then next thing is, what I want to do is to create a place to run Docker containers where Deis will run the apps. Now, where is that place? It's going to be here and here. And I have no machines here. I will create some. I can click the button to create a droplet, but that's not what I'm talking about. No, not at all. I want to create machines, but I want to use the copy and paste method of creating machines. You recall this copy and paste business? Where is that? Copy, paste. That's what I want to do. I want to paste something and have the infrastructure created for me automagically. Automagical. Did I say that? Yes, I did. So, yeah, paste. That's what I want to do, is through a paste or some execution of an automated command, I want to create whatever I need, and it just becomes available. So in my DO cloud, I want to have something already there by running Terraform. I'll apply Terraform to that cloud, and boom, I will have the whole thing ready so that I can play with it, right? That's what my goal is. Not messing around with the things inside right now. I'm not in the mood. So I'll use this tool. Okay, let's go.
Milesh, do you mind if we take a little break?
Break is fine. 8:10. So 8:10. So we have 5 minutes. 8:05 to 8:10. 5 minute break.
Nilesh, I have a question. Is Terraform similar to what SkyTab does?
I have no idea what SkyTab. Oh, that SkyTab thing. Okay, that's yeah, it's a test lab. SkyTab. Yeah, I know them. I know. It's a Seattle company, right?
Yeah.
They are not a tool. They are a service. What do they say?
Yeah,
they're a service. They give you on-demand environment to bring your business applications in life. So I think I know these guys.
They call it environment as a service. Basically, you can create your different test environments and then take it to production, do your labs. Is it something similar or is it more, because this is a service, it's a different model,
right.
But this provides similar application of creating a template.
I don't think they're not dealing with your infrastructure. Sorry. Go ahead.
They create the infrastructure on AWS.
Yeah, they will.
Or HP. Yeah.
Or VMware. But they are not open source, so I don't care. Sorry. I care about open source. Yeah, go ahead.
Yeah, my question was in terms of thinking about Terraform, is it similar or is it different?
No, it's very different. Terraform is similar to your this thing I mentioned. Okay, so in here you have this CloudFormation. That's the closest to Terraform.
Okay, got it. So it's an empty template. You have to go fill in the values and everything for the...
Isn't Terraform just a tool to allow you to automate the deployment of cloud instances instances in the cloud?
Correct.
I guess it's one of the
tools. Yeah, it's here. Okay. The definition is Terraform is a tool for building, changing, combining infrastructure safely and efficiently.
So it does instantiate. Like it does. It's not just template creation. It does instantiate.
It will instantiate machines for you. Yes. Yes. You will see. Okay. You will see it in a few. You will see that thing in a moment. I think Rebecca is having some question about where do you find the recordings. So I'm going to just paste a link for her. Pasting a link for Rebecca for BitTorrent Sync.
And I've got BitTorrent loaded and I've got a folder, but it doesn't seem to be happy, I guess.
So let me just check what your computer is doing with BitTorrent. I can see some of it, whether it is synchronized correctly or not. I can tell. You can also see
on my screen.
I'm looking at BitTorrent right now. It's loading. But as it is loading, I will go to a different screen and see if the other server that I have that runs BitTorrent is all happy and everything. Let us see. Not this. So which is my server? My server is for BitTorrent is here. So here is my BitTorrent sync and another computer. And I see that Rebecca is not connected. Okay, what does that mean? That you do not have recordings, Rebecca. So I need to fix that. So that means I will fix it by giving you a link to click on and then you should be able to get the recordings in place. So that's doing right now. And here is the link coming up for recordings for Rebecca and copy. And please click on this to get your recordings. And by the way, if you do not mind, Rebecca, just hang on. Don't click on the link. Do it after the session. Please do.
Oh, okay. Too much download. Okay.
Download from my computer. So just avoid it.
Okay.
And do it after the session, please. Thank you.
Thank you.
You're welcome.
Oh, you have that sync. Do you have that sync to an internal cloud in your house?
I do have a cloud, yes, in my garage, and I'll tell you more about it if you're interested later. So yes, I have a private little thing in which I run sync, and then I run it on my laptops and desktops and everywhere, and my lap and my iPhone and my iPad and everything. So just it runs everywhere. And so I am going to start again. Okay, 8:11. So back again. What we are doing is preparing our cloud. So we are going to do something like a paste, basically apply exercise, Terraform apply. And so that's the step that we have. We're going to copy it in a buffer and paste it here in this window. So let us go read that. So it says, Terraform apply something to the cloud. Okay, what do you want to apply again? So let's read that line by line. Okay, line by line. First thing, go to the right folder. The folder is base. So let's do that. Are we in the folder? Yes. Next. Next up, that part is taken care of. Good. Next one, Terraform apply something. What is that something? The first line is line number one. It says, okay, here's a token. Where is my token? That token is not the right token. This token is bad. So I will get the right token, which is here. So get it. I'll get my token and put that in the right location. In place of bad token, I have the token, the good one. And that's the token. Next thing, line number two. What do I need is my SSH keys fingerprint. You recall in a previous step, we have generated the SSH key fingerprint. And that looks like this. So we'll copy it, the fingerprint. And paste it in the bad fingerprint or old stale fingerprint. This fingerprint is stale, so I don't want to use it. Instead, I will use the fingerprint that I have right now for days pub key, which is this fingerprint. This is the right one. So I put in my token. I put in my SSH key fingerprint, not the key itself, not the public key, not the private key. I'm putting it the SSH keys fingerprint for the public days.pub. This fingerprint is what I obtained from the command line. You can also obtain the same fingerprint, D3, whatever I have, from the DigitalOcean website. Here and settings and security like that. And there is the fingerprint right there. You can obtain from the browser in DigitalOcean, or you can obtain from your terminal by generating the fingerprint for your days.pub file. So two ways, same thing. Now in our cloud, we don't have anything, but then this step will generate whatever we need for us. What do we need? We want to get some machines in the NYC region, New York City, number 3 region. That's line number 3. Line number 3 is this one. And then prefix. It's just a text prefix I want to use, DEIS. I want to get 3 instances of 8 gigabyte size and using the contribution DigitalOcean to Terraform. So this contribution to Terraform is made by DigitalOcean, or at least sponsored by DigitalOcean, so that Terraform works with DigitalOcean. So that's the entire command I will take in one shot and go to my terminal and make sure that I am in Safari on one end, in the browser on one end. So this is the command I want to type, but edit it first for token and keys, and then make sure to have the token and the key fingerprint correct. And the token needs to be obtained from DigitalOcean. SSH key needs to obtain from DigitalOcean, security and all that good stuff. And then you invoke that command in your terminal like this. So clean up and then paste the command in an entire one shot. And then hit enter and feel happy about it. And it failed. It says something, invalid syntax, the key fingerprint I pasted incorrectly apparently. And so three errors occurred. DigitalOcean droplet days parsing this D388. There was a mistake in copy and paste, apparently. So we'll do identify what that mistake was by going to the editor. Come on, editor. There we go. Atom editor, file, new window. Put it in this half here so people can see. And paste. Now, somewhere along the way, my token is all bad. Now, what is wrong with my token? My SSH keys are bad. That's what's complaining, right? So we will delete this and go to DigitalOcean like this and grab our token from the security settings, the DAIS token, like that, one more time, copy. And it's a clean copy, no mistakes, I hope. And then put that in the right location like this. And I hope there is no mistake here, but let's do it one more time. And if this is a problem, we'll see what's going on. So we are going to go to the clean screen, paste it. Okay, break one more time, clear screen and paste it. Verify that there are no syntax issues and then hit it. It is still complaining about invalid syntax.
Is the key bad or is the call wrong? Is there something wrong with the flag that you're using?
The flag is, it has tested like many, many times I've run this. The flag should not be wrong, but something wrong with the key itself. The invalid syntax, it says string conversion, parsing integer, parsing this, and invalid syntax. So we are going to read the syntax on Terraform. So let's go read the syntax itself on Terraform.
Do those continuation line characters have to be direct? After
Yes, sir. You're right. You're right. That may be the issue. So the continuation lines, we have to be putting a new line right after that. That must be the issue, right? That may be the exact issue, I suspect. You're right.
Well, I was saying those continuation lines, see how they're one space after the quote?
Yeah, one space after the quote is okay, but there should not be a trailing space after the continuation. That's the challenge.
Okay, yeah, because I know in Python that can be a problem.
Yes, you're right.
But Ruby's pretty similar.
So I'm going to
clean up. I'm assuming this is... Yeah, go ahead.
I'm cleaning up spaces which are trailing. So trailing spaces I'm cleaning right now. And the best way to save trailing spaces is actually to save this file. So I'll just save it on desktop somewhere. Or here, terraform.md save, and it will automatically show us any issues it might have. So save, and it should have cleaned up by now. So go minimize. Or if you know what, I'll just put everything in one line. That also works. If this doesn't work this time, I'm going to clean up and make sure everything goes in one line. So right now,
so you could also, instead of cut and pasting, you could just cat the file and pipe it into bin ZSH.
Yes. Yes. That's another way. So clean up, paste one more time. Nope. Parsing issue. So we'll create the file itself right inside the VM and then do the piping business or some other method. So there we go. We are going to create this file right inside this atom, which is your user data example. And we are going to create a new file. And I'm going to remove any issues around trailing, make it all one line and make it simple. And if not, we'll have to understand what that means from a syntax perspective. Is the key fingerprint not supposed to be in that format anymore? Is something changed between the last time I ran it? That's what we have to find out. Okay, so all of it is now in one line, which is a crazy long line, by the way, but that's what we have. So we are going to copy that, put that in the terminal, all of that in one line, and I hope this works. If not, we have to go and study whether these single quotes, are they okay or not? That's what I'm also worried about. These single quotes we have, are they single quotes or are they not single quotes but something else? So I'm going to remove the quotes altogether and then put my quote by hand like this. That may be the issue. Sometimes these quotes do not copy nicely from a browser. So I'm going to remove the quotes completely and come back and put the quotes right in the correct spot. So I can show you what I'm doing by making it big. And there we go. So this, what I'm doing is basically removing the quotes all over. There are a couple of quotes here. And then I'll put these quotes manually type them so that we avoid any quotes related issues.
I was going to say sometimes I see issues where if you cut and paste from a Windows machine, you can run a DOS to Unix utility and it'll clean it up.
Yes, 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 you're right. Yeah, that's somebody, probably a developer speaking there, right there, I can tell. Yes, a person experience, DOS to Unix. Totally, totally. So yeah, that quote, we have to manually handle these things. That's what we are doing right now.
So deleting all the line breaks and putting it into one line seemed to fix it.
Yeah, that's what we did. We just removed all the lines and put all in one line, yeah, and then also removing the.
It seemed to work. Okay.
Yeah, we hope it works. We still don't know whether it'll work, but we'll find out. And so I am just cleaning up all the single quotes, putting the single quotes by hand so that there are no copy paste issues. And that's the challenge that we
have. I left the backslashes in.
Yep. So we just cleaned up the whole thing by hand. And now I'm going to copy the whole thing again and copy. Oops. No, copy is Control C, not Command C. So copy is Control C. Okay, terminal, break the whole thing, paste it, and pray before you press enter. Oh no, okay, the format is changed. Apparently the syntax itself is changed. They don't want apparently this type because they're parsing and it says Terraform state file is partially updated within resources. Okay. String conversion, parsing an integer, parsing this invalid syntax. So apparently this format is not acceptable, which means we have to find out what they want. Now, they must have changed something.
I'm pasting what I had into the public chat here.
Okay.
And it works.
You in Babel chat?
Yeah, in Babel chat. That works.
Okay.
But that has my key. That has my key and tokens in it. So you probably want to replace those.
I understand. I did not yet receive the token and your command yet. But I would like, you know, if it works on your laptop, why don't you just share your screen and we work on your laptop instead?
Oh, yeah, we can do that.
There we go. That's so much
it
better.
It should be in. It's not in Bubble Chat. That's interesting.
Not in Bubble Chat yet. But here we go. We transition to your laptop. If it works there, let's go follow along with you. You know, so there we go. Project, please. Yeah, there we have it. So you have created. Okay, seems like your apply completed. Zero added, zero something, something. So go to DigitalOcean website and tell us what they show. They show you. They should show you three machines there. So on DO.
Oh, really? Okay.
Yeah, they should. You should see three machines right there in DO. So go to DO and tell us what you see. Yeah.
Yeah. Here it is. Okay. So
on DO, go to the home page, and there you should see three machines. Droplets, three droplets up and running. There we have days 1, 2, 3, right? Okay. So you note down the IP addresses of these guys on a sheet of paper that we will be using them. So we have to go and play with your laptop instead of mine. Fine. No problem. I'll investigate further what's going on my side, but I don't care. On your machine, let us follow along with the sequence, and I'll guide you through as we proceed. So let's go back to the write-up on one screen. Keep the DigitalOcean active. Open the write-up that I have, which is, I'll paste a link for you in Slack chat. There we have it. So here, yeah, so we just applied these things on Terraform to create a cloud for us. We just did that. Next up is the second complex thing to do, and this involves setting up DNS. Some of you are very familiar with it, and others are new to DNS. But to apply a DNS correctly, we need to have a domain name. Like in this example, I'm using a wildcard DNS record. I'm creating a wildcard DNS record called star.hello.cloudgenie.us. Okay? And by the way, this record creation I will do on my side, so you don't have to worry about it. At least you will see it. You may not be set up to create a DNS record for a domain. That's why I'm suggesting that let me handle it. If you have a domain, go.
Yeah, that's fine.
But what I'm on the write-up, we have, I'm going to bring back the screen. Bring the screen back in the view so everybody can see. Otherwise, everybody will not be able to see that, right? So in here, what we are essentially doing is using an existing domain, which is cloudgenie.us, prefixing a hello to it. This hello becomes an intermediate string of characters that allows me to not disturb my existing services that I have on cloudgenie.us, but instead it becomes a separate level, completely different from the main domain. And I'm treating this hello dot as a top, as a domain, for example, by itself, which means hello.cloudgenie.us needs a DNS server. It needs to maintain its own DNS zone file, which means I need to have a DNS service provider that will give me services for hello.cloudgenie.us. So that is the top level domain we'll be using, and everything will live under it. Which means if you create an application on, say, heroku.com, it will give you, happy-einstein.something.something.heroku.com, or sleepy-nilesh.heroku.com or something like that. They'll give you fancy words they'll come up with and then prefix it to herokuapp.com and then give you a pointer, and that is where your application will become visible. I am, in this example, doing pretty much the same thing, except it is not heroku.com instead, but hello.cloudgenius.com is the site, the TLD, the top level domain. What does that mean? Once we have the DNS configured correctly, we will be able to generate an app, or maybe take an app and deploy it on our own platform as a service, this one. And it will generate a custom name for us, such as I said, a Happy Einstein. By the way, Heroku is known to make up these fancy names. They'll take an adjective and put against a scientist's name and then make a fancy word out of it and then use that as a name for an app. And that's what Heroku is doing for many, many years. So everybody else is copying the same style, including Days. So you will have a randomly generated word as a prefix to hello.cloudgenie.us generated, and that is where your app will live. To enable that, we have to have a DNS entry that is written down right there in the blue highlight, which is star.hello.cloudgenie.us. So you can see that one I'm highlighting right now. This should have an A record entry for each machine's IP address, which means we have three machines right there, days 1, 2, 3. So we need to create A records like IP address, three entries. Then apps can then be accessed by the browser at app name. So this app name will be randomly generated for us for the app that we will deploy, followed by hello.cloudgenie.us. So that suffix is common to all the apps. The apps we deploy will live here. App name, whatever name you choose, or it will give you, is what will become presentable and accessible. Now, having done that part, we have to create an entry like this with an A record with multiple IP addresses like these guys that you see on the Chrome browser, like days 1, 2, 3. These three machines on the left side, they have IP addresses. So we will take those IP addresses and put them against this entry, like this specific entry. And then we have to create three more records, which are these entries, days 1, days 2, days 3, .hello.cloudgenie.us, and then A record for each of these names and the IP address corresponding to that. And that is what it will show as a result. After you put all the entries, the table will look something like the picture below the picture that you see. So scroll up a little bit, and then I should be able to, all of us should be able to see the picture. Now, what you see right there is very tiny little words, is a picture or screenshot taken from the DNS provider. The DNS provider for cloudgenie.us is Amazon. But our domain name is different. It is hello.cloudgenie.us. And for that domain, I want to use a different cloud provider, not this one, not the Amazon one. What does that mean? It means if you go to the terminal and then type dig and cloudgenie.us and ns name server. So please type dig space cloudgenie.us space ns. You will see that this thing is going for its DNS, so cloudgenie.us followed by ns. Dig, no DNS, followed by cloudgenie.us, followed by ns. It'll show you the name server currently being used by the domain. No DNS, just ns. Ns only. So name servers. Up arrow, backspace, name server. Ns. Bingo. And so here we have an indication that my domain, cloudgenie.us, is currently using the Amazon name servers, as you can see from aws-dns-53.org and blah, blah, blah. Those four of them. That's okay. But that is not the domain we want to use. We want to use a different domain called hello.cloudgenie.us. So we will need to get a domain name service provider for that domain. And that is what I intend to do next. So, Patrick, do you have a Google Cloud account already? If not, no worries. I have it. No worries. I have it. So I will take over. I will like you to paste the IP addresses of these machines in the chat window. By the way, your previous chat never came through. So please paste it in the Badal chat. I would like to get the IP addresses of these three boxes that you have. And then I will switch to me presenting and take away the display from you. And I will show you the next step here in Google Cloud Console, where I'm going to take over and show you the, where is this GoToMeeting? Okay. Oh, there we have it. So GoToMeeting, I'm changing the presenter back to Nilesh, showing my screen, going to Google Cloud. And in cloud.google.com, we are going to use the Google Cloud DNS as an example. So I'm going there right now, Google Cloud Console, and there are a bunch of services in the dashboard. I will go and find if I have the Cloud DNS service somewhere here. Okay, where is that? Compute Engine, instances, where is the DNS service? They're hiding it or what? API, billing, cloud launcher, networking, DNS. Okay, there it is. So here, in my Google Cloud, there is this service called DNS. And your Terraform apply just came through, by the way, in Badal chat. So we have it, but we don't have the, we now have the IP address also. So now here, what you're looking at in my screen is a empty slate, like really empty. And this is the reason I chose to give you a clean slate, empty slate, to help you understand the DNS and its allocation for a given scenario, like we are doing it right now. So what we are going to do is basically put these things side by side again, setting DNS. So on the right side, you have an empty slate. So I'm going to create a zone. The zone will be called hello.cloudgenie.us. That's the top level domain I want to use, right? And I'll call it just hello. And then description is optional. So I don't want to have anything in there. Just keep it blank. And I'm creating this zone. The zone got created, which means I'm getting a bill. And not only that, I have to make sure that these records are set for Google name servers for my hello.cloudgenie.us. So what I will do is my original name provider, which is Amazon. And this is the complexity involved here. We are creating and treating an existing domain and a subdomain of that as a separate domain. If that was confusing, I will repeat. We are using an existing domain, call it cloudgenie.us, and that is currently managed by Route 53 in AWS as the DNS. And we are going to use hello.cloudgenie.us as a subdomain, as a standalone domain with a new name service provider from Google. So it's very, very, very different way of understanding. We're using a subdomain, hello, of this domain as a standalone domain here. I hope you understand this. If not, ask me questions. And to enable this scenario to happen and successfully happen, we need to have the name servers given by this guy given to this guy. And so they just gave us some name servers, right? 1, 2, 3, 4, whatever. We have to provide this info to here so that this will know that this address, even though it is a subdomain, I want to handle it and treat it as a full-fledged domain here. And that is what we just got from Google right there. So Google says, you know what, please put these name servers in your account. Okay, I will do that. So I'll go to Amazon console where my account actually exists. And there I have Route 53. And in Route 53, I look for my domain, which is this hosted zone, which is not hello.cloudgenie.us, but just cloudgenie.us, that one. And in there, I will look for my existing records, if I have anything called hello. And apparently I do. And from a previous exercise that I may have done some time ago, I have these name servers already in place. They are stale, old, bad, wrong, because the names are different. This time the names on the right side are different. So I need to remove these name servers, gone, and add these four name servers. So 1, 2, 3, 4 that I need to go grab. So I will take them all like this, copy, give it to Amazon, and make sure that they are added on to the Amazon's records. And then I save the record set. And this way, I now have updated the name servers corresponding to hello.cloudgenie.us. And this way, in a minute or so, in about 60 seconds, I will see that my name records show up on the internet, which means I should be able to go back to my terminal and dig for cloudgenie.us for name server. And I still see Amazon, good. Now I dig for hello.cloudgenie.us for name server. And do I dig the right ones? Absolutely, I do. I see the updated records D1, D2, D3, D4 show up, which means these records are now in place, which means I can now treat hello.cloudgenie.us as a standalone full-fledged domain with zone details available to me in the Google Cloud DNS right here for the zone called hello. And this is where I can add other zone entries in my file. So I want to do that now. I will go back to my write-up, and it says hello.cloudgenie.us should have a record entries for each machine's IP address. So which means I need to create this entry. So I will add a record set for *.hello.cloudgenie.us with an A record entry for each of the machine IP addresses we got from our friend Patrick. So we got one machine out here. Bingo. Add another item. Second machine out there. And add another item. We got third machine right there. Copy, bring it here, paste. We got three machine IP addresses added to a common one record corresponding to *.hello.cloudgenie.us. And this is what we are doing. And so what we are going to do is take a screenshot of this so that you will have an idea about what I just did, just in case, and captured it and pasted it for you here. So that's the one action that we just did. And then I'm going to create that record. As a result, you find this updated record showing up in the screenshot, looks like this. So that screenshot is coming to you in Slack chat again. And that's what it looks like. Back here in next step, we have to create three individual records for A records for these names, days one, days two, days three. So create record set, days one. Oops, just say days one, like that. And then type in the first IP address, which is here. Copy. And Patrick, you don't have to do this because I'm doing it for your case. Other people who are doing it, you can follow along if you are, but don't have to, because you will have ample time to do this on your own later. So this is the first record. I added it right there. I'm going to create two more, add record set. This is the second one with the second IP address coming up from Slack chat from Patrick, and paste it and save it. That got the second record. Now days three, copy, create a record set. Days number three, IP address coming from Slack chat like that, copy, bring it here, paste, save. And now we have three records, days one, days two, days three, all to the three IP addresses that we have. And that's how the end result looks like, as you see in the screen here, where I'm pasted a screenshot of this thing. And now we should test and validate the DNS before we proceed forward. At this moment, I cannot do anything on my machine because it is the key that Patrick has that can actually do anything forward. So we need to go make Patrick a presenter again, and we'll follow along with the validation steps. So Patrick, you are the presenter now. Did I make you presenter yet? Make the presenter. Did I make you a presenter? There is a chat question. Can you make me a presenter? Yeah, not made you a presenter yet. So there we go. You have to click this button to make him a presenter. So now you are a presenter, which means we can now follow along on your machine and see if the DNS validation succeeded. And that's what we'll do. So we'll do a test and validation of the DNS. If the DNS succeeded, you should be able to see that on Patrick's machine, which means we have to go back to the browser and read the instructions from there and then follow along on terminal. So please bring the browser.
Let me get that browser up here. Hold on. I've got too much.
Yeah. Okay. No worries.
Let's see here. It's not that one. So let's see. Sorry.
No worries. You have the Edge browser. I think you have where the write-up is. So.
Well, that's what it was right here. Yeah. So I was doing it on my own.
I know.
There we go.
Yeah. Yeah, you are super familiar with DNS, so you don't have to worry about it. You know DNS already.
Yeah, so this is what you're looking for?
Yes, so let us test and validate the DNS before proceeding forward. So we are looking at the three steps, SSH-T options. The SSH-T steps, you have to test and validate the connections. And so SSH-T core at days1.hello.cloudgenerator. So try that one at a time. Make sure we are able to successfully test the SSH connection to the machine by name as opposed to IP address. We are trying it by name to validate DNS. So you can click on the command, copy it using a regular Windows style copy. And when you paste the command, you have to press Control, Shift, and V. So in the terminal, Control, Shift, and V. Oh, that also works. Yes, the mouse always works. So I don't use mouse. So enter, and it should validate whether the connection succeeded. Let us see what it says. It says line 16, bad configuration, host name, touch. You have to go rename your config, SSH config file. Please rename that to config.save or something. So go to .ssh folder and type in this command. I'll just give you a command, hold on. Type in this command, mv space tilde, hold on, let me just type it. mv /tilde.ssh/config /config.example.config.save. Now type this command and that will remove your configuration file, which we don't want right now, and instead rename it to safe, something.safe. And so that is what is coming in the way right now. So your configuration from a previous example from Amazon Exercises is coming in the way. And so you paste it, rename it, and that will go aside with a different file name called .safe. And now you run it again, test again. And this will see if it works with the testing, and it did successfully. Say yes to it, and you repeat that for the other guys. So it successfully tested the connection to this guy closed. Nice. Next one, copy and paste. I never tried this mouse based pasting on terminal, but that's nice to know that it works.
That's the only way I know how to do it. or use the keystrokes. Or use the keystrokes where it's not Control V Shift. That's just a little bit.
I know. So you have to say yes to it. You have to say yes to it. Say enter. And then the next one. Okay.
We figure out how to do things.
I know. Yeah, oh, somebody was, you know, having a hard time with VI. Oh, man. That was...
You know what, though? Uh-huh. There were times, not recently, but maybe about 15 years ago, where I wanted VI and I couldn't find it. I couldn't run it on a Windows machine because you can program stuff. You can actually write script in VI. And it's a very powerful thing.
Yes.
VI is a crazy good machine. I mean, it's good.
Okay. So,
after you've after you've suffered through it for like a year.
A year, like in 5 years. But there's, you realize there are things that you can do in VI you can't do in any other test editor.
You can, but the thing is, VI is so small. It'll if you find even like a little tiny machine with a micro Linux OS on it, it's gonna have VI, but it might not have anything else but VI. Yeah, so it's the go-to. It's the go-to editor, you know.
Yeah, exactly. But then some people find. By the way, I cracked a joke on Bartle saying, you know, it is for the last 40 years since VI was created in 1976. People are still using VI because they don't know how to get out of it, WQ, right? They don't know this, so they're still using it. Okay, let's keep going. Let's keep going.
Hey, that's enough of making fun of me.
Ouch.
And no talking about my deleting my SSH folder either.
Oh, my gosh. I did not bring it up, man. But keep going. Let's go. Days control is installed already, so you have to check for Days control version. So Days CTL version is a verification for the step Days control. If it is not installed, I think it is installed. But if it is not installed, that's how you get it. So you just copy it, paste it, should work. It should. You should have it already. So you can skip the next step, which is basically, I found it. Not found. Interesting. Okay, that means we have to install it. So let's go install. So you have to go make mkdir/bin if it exists. If it doesn't, I think it exists. So go check whether the bin directory exists. And so please follow along here. If it doesn't exist, we'll... So create that one. No, not this bin, but it has to be a slash bin. Not this bin. It says it exists. Okay, then you can skip that step. You just go cd dot dot and cd bin. So go dot dot and bin. So back a step. Cd dot dot. Go one step back and go inside bin. And if it doesn't exist, this Days control doesn't exist, then go to cd/bin, enter, and list out contents. So we'll see what is inside. And in there, you will find a ton of material. What are you finding here? Hold on. Let's see. PWD, please. So type PWD. I think you went to the slash bin, apparently. You have to go to the /bin, not the slash bin. So you have to be in the cd, enter, and cd /bin. You'll say cd /bin. So see the command type there, /bin. No, not this bin. You have to have tilde, which is above the tab. Yeah, /, and then bin. That's a different bin than the main bin. Okay, you don't have it. Okay, then please, the previous command, type in exactly what it says. So first step, before you go any further, cd enter.
No, oh, I'm in.
No, cd I'm enter. In. You're not in cd enter. You have to type cd enter, you go to a different location, which is your home. This is your root. So cd enter.
Okay.
Ha, you have messed around with your laptop, apparently. Okay, sorry. So yeah, your home is changed. You have messed around with your virtual machine a little bit. So something has changed, but no worries. Let us do these steps now. Like I'm saying, I'm going to type these for you. So there we go. So we are going to create a folder. I'm typing it right now. Mkdir.
Oh.
Yeah, I'm typing it for you. Break it. Control C. Control C, and then type the whole thing by hand. I think this trailing quote you have, the single quote, is hurting. Yeah, enter. Okay. Now the next one is here. the next command is to go in that folder, user bin, home user bin.
Okay.
Yep. And now list out the contents of this folder, which is what we are interested in. Okay, so in that folder, now you can follow along in the steps that you have right there in the write-up.
Okay.
So curl, curl, that one, the curl step, and then the sudo step. So this curl thing is downloading that binary from days.io. This is a days control binary, which is basically allowing us to control our own platform. So this binary is getting downloaded. We will then make an entry in our make it executable. This is the second step. The sudo lnfs that you have is making it executable. And so that's what we are going to do as soon as this step finishes. We are basically grabbing that binary days control to control our platform. And it takes a little bit of time to download this. Now you have it. Now you paste the next one. Cloud Genius. So I think this step is probably not, break it, not necessary. Hold on, let me think. User local bin. Okay, go ahead. Up arrow, enter Cloud Genius. Up arrow, enter Cloud Genius. So this, what we are basically doing is placing a link from the current location to the user local bin directory, so it makes it executable. Now you can check for days control version, days.ctl --version. And if it works okay, then we are going back to the days folder. And this will check the version for that particular days control. Version should show us 110.1. Days CTL 110.1 should be visible. It should be working. Yes, we have it. Now let us go back to not that type command. I think there's a machine change you have done. So please type this thing to go to the right location, which is what I'm typing right now. CD home user and then days. That's what you need to type on your machine. This is slightly different because your machine is slightly differently set up. I don't know why. Probably you're having too much fun with the workstation. So that's what you type to go to the right spot. Not the instruction. The instruction will not work for you for some specific reason. You have to go up arrow and break the last trailing. So break it, Control C, and paste it without the trailing quote. So CD home user days. CD /home/user/days will take you to the right location. And then we'll follow along with the next step, which is enable keyless login. So you are in the right spot back again. Now you have to enable keyless login, which is basically evaluating the SSH agent and then adding the SSH key. This part is something that I should talk about because this is not super clear what exactly is going on. So the idea behind, run it please. The idea behind this thing is that, you know what, you recall when you type SSH and then username at machine address or IP address or some other thing, go hit it. And then you keep typing. So that should not be a problem. I'm just describing this concept. The concept is anytime you have a SSH command that you have to physically pass around an argument called -i. Followed by the private key name, right? That step we are bypassing by doing the last command that he just did. Patrick just did something called SSH add. It remembers the private key. It says identity added. home user dot SSH days, it will remember that that's the private key you want to use. Don't run this command, please do not. That will break it. Don't run it, it'll mess up. That cd command, don't run it on your machine because something is broken on your, or rather I should say something is different on your laptop. So don't use cd commands. Everything else, keep on working. So here in the command right now, Patrick is exporting a variable. It will basically be the tunnel or a reference to the tunnel which we'll be using to connect to the cloud. That tunnel will be our days1.hello.cloudgenie.us, the first machine. And then we are listing out all the things that we have in our cloud, which is going to be currently empty. So it should show you empty right now. Unit, machine load, active, sub, nothing. Bingo. And now is a good time to install the platform as a service. How do you do that? Bingo. Copy, copy, copy. Five steps and you have it. So this step takes 10 minutes, by the way, roughly. It's a long step because you have three machines. You have to download code, install it, run it by itself. So it takes a little time, but it will happen. And so first step happened. Now the second step is to configure the platform set with domain name hello.cloudgenie.us. That will happen quickly. Then the install platform step takes some time. And then starting takes some more time. So those two steps take a little time. We'll just be patient with it. And in that time, we will talk about what we are doing. So let us begin installing, and then I'll describe what's going on. So install. And this will basically install Days platform on the three droplets that you now have set up with Terraform. And so that is installing now. It will take about 7 minutes. So stand by. This thing will take time. Roughly about seven, estimated. And we are crossing the hour. But let it run, and I'll describe some of the concepts here that we missed. SSH add concept. This concept remembers the private key. So you don't have to give it every single time by typing dash I option. I think you remember what I'm talking about, right? SSH something. Oh, this was fast. Wow. Okay, please run start platform to boot up. Maybe this will take time. Something takes time, I remember. I don't know which exact step takes time, but something takes time to start. Okay, so if this finishes really fast, I'll be surprised and actually be disappointed because something went wrong if it did not actually install it or something. But I think it'll work. So I'm not worried. Now let us understand what's going on. Right now, this thing, install platform step, basically downloaded the code from GitHub and injected references from our laptop. The user configuration file, if you recall, that was sent. And rest of the code was a Git reference coming from GitHub. So it installed all the software that was needed from GitHub open source and loaded up on those three machines. Next activity is to actually install it on those three machines. This is now going to create Docker container system. And we haven't actually discussed Docker because we are not going to use Docker right now. We are going to go to a higher level of abstraction, the platform level abstraction, and we are making use of it as a platform for us to application that we can run. We'll deploy applications on this platform. We are not going deeper right now with Docker, but we will, you know, in the third segment, we will discuss Docker at a great, to your heart's desire. And if you want to go deeper, I'm okay. And if you want extra time with me, I always welcome that. Of course, we will do in the sessions. A question there.
Now, yeah. what we're doing right now, how long would it take to do it manually?
Never tried, so I don't know.
Okay.
Yeah, but
it's a long time.
Yeah, it's a nightmare to do it by hand. Nobody does it. So
okay, cool.
I never tried. I don't want to try. This is mind blowing. No. You can read the code and see what it takes to build it. It's mind-blowing. You don't want to do it by hand. Nobody does it.
Like you'd have to do it on all three different machines and get it right on each machine and blah, blah, blah. Yeah.
That's right. Yeah, it is important to understand what's going on than actually doing it. And so once you have it understood, then you go deeper in terms of, okay, how do I change something or maybe make something different or maybe look at Flink or Cloud Foundry or something else. They all basically do the same thing. You give them the app, they will run it for you on your domain, on our domain, this happens to be hello.cloudgenie.us. That's the top-level domain we are using, and we will then, in a subsequent step, take a sample application, deploy it on the cloud, on this cloud, with our own platform, and see it running. And you will, you know, do this exercise yourself also. And before that, I suggest that you do the other exercise, which is simpler. It's simpler because it's like building an app and then deploying it on a ready-made platform, as opposed to struggling with this complexity, which can go wrong, like it did on my laptop. I still don't know why it went wrong, but something I must have missed on my machine somewhere.
I took exactly out of the course here, and I added it in like you did, and it came back, and it didn't like the end of line, so I just eliminated those, put it all into one line, and it worked fine.
So. Yep. In my machine, I don't know what, but something seems to be different. And that happens with when you play, you treat your computers as toys. That's what happens. And I do it all the time.
Yeah.
So yeah, I understand. By the way, in your laptop, your workstation, Cloud Genius workstation, Patrick, you seem to have modified your default path for some reason, or by mistake or by knowledge, I don't know.
Yeah, I don't know. Of course, I don't know how I did that, but
but we can fix it very easily, because what you can do is either clinically fix the exact location as to what may have gone wrong, or alternatively just kill the whole workstation to get a new one.
I've got stuff on it now that I was trying to save, but I can just rebuild it.
Right.
But that's like you said, you know, cows versus pets.
Cows and pets, right.
Yep. This is a cow, so I can go ahead.
Yeah, this is a cow. Yeah, your laptop is not a cow, right? Your laptop is a pet, but this is a cow.
Yeah, well, but this workstation here is also becoming kind of a pet because I got all this good stuff on it, so.
Okay, don't make it a pet. Don't make the workstation a pet. Keep it a cow. So the more you make it a pet, it'll be hard for you to get rid of and then restart from fresh if you like to. That's the hard part.
I think I can make it I've got several snapshots, so I can actually start up a different snapshot.
Right, possibly you can go back a step and By the way, Patrick, you seem to have a ton of experience with DNS, given your Exchange experience, so you're probably comfortable with this DNS thing.
Yeah. I was actually trying to determine if I could create this whole thing on my own dynamic DNS. But
yeah, yes, you can. And I think you're looking at some DNS solution there. What is that third tab on your Edge browser? The DNS tab?
Yeah, let's see, where did it go?
The third tab on the Edge browser, not this. Edge.
There it is, right there. Yeah, it's for my Exchange server.
Dyn. Dyn is good, right? Yeah, you could potentially do this. Like, you can create a TLD called platform.redmondturcat.net and have a completely isolated, or you can just use a redmondturcat.net top level. That also works.
Yeah.
And were trying to do that, but does it allow you to go a top level *.redmondturcat.net, does it do that? Let you do that?
I don't know, in fact.
Yeah, try, give it a shot. So paste, instead of days, paste a star, asterisk.
Star, okay.
Yeah, in the current window, in the host name, not the data name.
Oh, put a star, okay.
Yeah, so there is a request for a question for homework. The question is, what is the homework? The homework is to do two steps. One of them is the copy-paste Heroku exercise. I'm just trivializing it. It is not that trivial. I just called it a copy and paste exercise, but it is a little bit more than that. So that is one. And if you really find it really, really boring copy and paste, don't do it. I just said right now. If you find that the Heroku exercise is merely copy and paste, please do not do it. Do not. Nothing in this class is a requirement unless you have it, you find it interesting to do it, only then you do it. If you find that something is boring, don't do it. Tell me that it is boring instead. Tell me that, you know what, Nilesh, this copy and paste, I will not do it because I find it boring, and that is okay. So having said that, do not do something if you find something boring. Next one.
Okay, so besides that one, what else we have?
The second exercise is this exercise we are doing right now. I would like you to do that also on your own domain, just like we are doing right now. So that's the second exercise that I would like you to do, and that's the homework. With that, I know some of us have to go, and that's okay to go. You can hang up. And again, one last one. Do not do any exercise if you find it boring.
Okay, so you want the, both of these done by Saturday?
That is too early, and I understand. So that's why.
Yes, okay.
Yeah, it's too early to make them all because you have full-time jobs, so I understand.
Yeah,
so,
exactly.
Yeah, so
all right.
The next day, by that time, I think we should be able to do it. But the day after, I guess, which is a Tuesday. So I hope by Tuesday you should be able to do it. So try that.
Okay, sounds great. Thank you so much.
Yes, you're welcome. Bye.
And Nilesh?
Yes.
I had a question regarding just SSH agent in general. So the SSH agent, it's not actively running normally, but when you launch it, you start a process that's you start an SSH agent process, and is the only purpose so you can add multiple keys?
Yes. Sometimes the agent is running by itself automatically. Some machines will not have it running, so you have to evaluate it to make it run, and then you can remember like five or six keys at a time, and then it'll by rotation try one key, doesn't work, try the next key, doesn't work, try the next key, doesn't work, and then one of the keys works, and then it lets you in.
So what if you launch the agent, add multiple keys, and then you kill that agent process? Will it still remember the keys, or will it only remember that one default?
I think it will. If you kill the process, you have to restart, but it will remember the added keys. I think it saves the added keys.
Okay. So you only need the agent to add the keys.
Yeah. I think you can check, but validate this by doing it. I don't remember what the behavior will be. So the SSH add command, you add a couple of keys, then you kill the agent and see what happens when you start the agent back up. So just examine the experience, what you get. And by the way, multiple keys with one machine and multiple keys failing one after the other, the machine might lock you out. So just be careful. Don't have bad keys.
Yep.
Just continue waiting? Is this still working?
Yeah, this is okay. Yeah. This is totally expected.
Yeah,
okay. Yeah, totally expected. Okay. And I hope Patrick can stay with me. If not, we'll have to do the whole thing again. But I hope you can stay.
No, I'm fine.
Yeah, you're fine.
I just may have to take a break here. Hold on.
Yeah. We'll give it a few more minutes for it to work and finish off the install part. And then the rest of the activity is not that time consuming. So it doesn't have a whole time as such. So if you can please scroll the terminal window and we can see what else is written there, because that is interesting to read. You can see that it is starting days, storage subsystem, active running, then logging subsystem, active and running, control plane, active and running, and a bunch of other things will eventually start and active and running. And these things will show up in a list of things that are active and running at the end. So the last command here we have is days list, and that command will list out what is running once we have everything running. So that thing is starting. That's what you're looking at here. You're starting. And when the thing starts, that we should be able to view it.
Yeah, sorry, I had to drain a kidney here. Hold on. So then we do this list, and then these, all these things should be...
Yeah, they just show us the list of things running right now. They'll have a builder service, controller service, database service, logs, logspot service, publisher service, registry service, router service, store daemon service, store gateway service, store metadata service, store monitor service, store volume service, this and that. So all these things running. That's what we will be able to see once the thing starts properly. And that is what we are looking at.
Okay. Oh, cool. It did go to the next one. It was that database, now builder service. Okay,
yeah,
cool.
Yeah, it will move. Yeah, it takes a little bit of time to set up all these services, but then it. The last time I saw it was like about 9 minutes or 10 minutes overall activity. This slow step took about 10 minutes.
It's a little bit long here, but. Okay.
Yeah, it's like longer than 10, I guess now. 2102 is when we started, and it is 2116.
Yep.
Right? The command started at 2102. So it's about a little bit longer than 10. And this waiting is the hard part. I cannot wait. I have so little patience.
Yeah, I know. I used to do the same thing when I was installing stuff for clients, especially Exchange. I got into the habit of doing other things while it was going on.
That's right. Go grab coffee or do something else while you wait.
Yeah.
Yeah.
And then all of a sudden it's done, and you go, oh, cool.
Yeah, that's what I'm looking to see, and I think we will see that.
And later, I have a question.
Yes.
And this may be, there are no stupid questions, so I'll ask. So we are installing a PaaS, right? Platform as a service.
Correct.
Does it mean that other developers, let's say like Patrick has this PaaS setup, and I can go and deploy a app in that PaaS rather than creating my own PaaS?
Correct. Only if Patrick allows you to.
Okay.
So Patrick has to allow you, give you access, and then you can.
Because I'm thinking like if it's similar to Heroku, that's what...
Correct.
It becomes, right?
You have to give credit card to Heroku before Heroku will allow you. So you have to give...
Okay, and allowing would mean, like, what kind of settings would I go and change? Or I'm just trying to understand...
SSH key, access keys. You need to have keys in place. If you have the keys in place, you will go in and deploy.
That could be a
question. You have to have your keys added. You have to have your keys added to his PaaS, and then you can, if you have the key to add an application, you can. So
where come from? Like, is it
the
keys that
I come from? The key will be generated by you and added by Patrick.
Yeah, but it is the same keys that we just did initially in this exercise and passed that along?
Similar. Not the same, but similar.
Not the same. Yeah, I get that because that's just an instance.
Yes, yes.
But as an object, it would be the same thing.
Yes. Yeah.
Now, if I was not following best practices, I could literally email her the private key, and she could utilize that key also, right?
Yes. 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 That's a crude way of doing it, but yes. Yes, possible.
But we don't want to do.
You can pass the private key, and then you basically give access. But don't do that. Yeah, don't do that.
Yeah.
The proper way is to generate your keys and have Patrick add them.
I understand the steps that need to be taken to build that, but I'm still not very clear on architecturally how's that working.
So we will go to that discussion at appropriate time. Once we need to understand Docker. to understand what's going on here. And so we will have Docker sessions in the third segment, which is February something, 25, something like that.
Okay.
That's when we'll start. But in the interim, we will do a whole lot more of Chef and other toolkits for DevOps. We'll get that clarity. We'll also, in the third segment, we will go into some of the things that are new technologies, such as, you know, relatively new, such as Docker, Ansible, other things such as looking at examples of business cases in real life. We'll take Netflix as an example and understand what Netflix has done to build its own cloud and how they operate, how they architect the whole thing. There are multiple examples that we can take a look at in terms of deployment from an architectural standpoint on what that can be done in the context of cloud given a business scenario. So there are multiple scenarios for a variety of types of industries and businesses that we can take an example from and then build out what would it take to build something for that industry, that company, or and then draw it out in terms of from a concept perspective. And then if you are interested, go into implementation. But that implementation itself requires an example application, which you may not have. That's a challenge.
My question was more on this particular exercise, you know, like that we're creating a path. So I know the steps that we're taking, but where are we doing what kind of thing is not very...
I will clarify that. In simple language, I would say that we have three boxes in DigitalOcean. On three boxes, we have installed Docker. And on top of that Docker infrastructure, we are going to create these services that are actually happening right now. So these services that are being generated are essentially running as services in those Docker containers.
Okay.
That's what you're looking at. So that's what you see right now is activating start post builder service. And when those activities finish, you will have a list of things running. And then we will do the next step of creating a application. When you create an application, you're basically doing the whole thing on your laptop. And then when you put that application in a Git commit, and then you use the client utility called Days that they have given us, and then push it, then you push that to your own platform. And you're basically sending your application to run on top of these Docker containers, and the services running will manage it. They will also generate a DNS record for you, such as a randomly generated name that you will see once we get to that point, that will associate itself with the DNS hello.cloudgenie.us that you have. And then using this framework, you can run your application on your platform. And when it runs on the platform that you just created, you can use it from a browser. Whatever app you built, it will just show up in your browser on the address that it will give you back. So you give it the app, in return, this infrastructure will give you an IP address or rather a DNS name on your domain. So it will be something like xyz.hello.cloudgenius. And that's the domain name where your app will run. So you give the app, it'll give you a DNS name back. That's where it'll run. So you open it up. And when you open that app in a browser, you will see your app running. It will run in a Docker container or a collection of containers managed by these services that are running again in Docker within those three boxes that you have.
What if I have proprietary services?
You have to fit into the model of a platform. Just like Heroku asks you, you have to be structuring your applications to fit into the model that the PaaS supports. So most platforms have a very well-disciplined model of writing an application in a given language. So we'll be using some, I think it's a Ruby example in this case. So for every language, they have a framework, and you have to fit into that framework for you to be able to write an application. So you cannot take any random app you can think of and put it on a platform. It has to fit into the discipline provided and required by the platform. Any random app you can think of, let's say I want to run Microsoft Word on this platform, no, it will not. It will not run. It has to follow the discipline prescribed by platform as a service. That discipline is...
If I have a proprietary service, can I, if it follows the rules, can I deploy that?
Yes.
On a PaaS?
Yes. You can even create custom services, which requires extra work. Yes.
That's my question. If I, because there are some industries and companies that need that additional services.
Yes, totally.
Let's say for finance purposes, right? If financial industry would have its own services. So.
Yes.
So, I don't know if you've noticed, Neelish. Netflix actually completely restructured their interface. Did you notice that?
No. Can you show us?
Yeah, here. I'll see if I can bring it up here.
So how many of us are still there online? Okay. We have Patrick, we have Shikha, Ted, Cal. That's it. Okay.
So this, as you see, this is totally different.
Oh wow, this is so different.
It's looking like Apple TV somewhat, maybe.
Yeah, that's probably what they wanted to replicate. Yeah, but yeah, so it's totally different. It used to be, you know, the slide strip either side. Now it's up down and also. Backwards and forwards. It's crazy.
Interesting. I'm not a Netflix user.
By the way, this is Marvel's Jessica Jones. That's actually a pretty good show, by the way, if you haven't seen it yet.
I don't have Netflix, then, so I need to
understand.
No, I don't have Netflix.
Oh, my goodness.
I know, it's crazy, right?
Oh my goodness.
Yeah, I'm probably the few
that
do not have Netflix because I don't watch television at all. I mean, I don't at all watch TV. It this for last 30 years. The last time I remember watching television was when back in India. Shikha might know this. Ramayana and Mahabharata. That's what I watched, and then I stopped.
Wow.
Well, if you've got family and all that kind of stuff, that's probably
journey. Yeah, there is no TV. I have a TV in my home, but I don't go in that room.
That's funny.
I mean, I go and I don't look.
The news? You don't watch the news?
I do get my news, but I have three monitors through which I get my news.
Oh, you mean Patrick, late night TV? That's my news.
No TV at all for me. Absolutely no TV. That's how I'm able to find time to study all this, right? Otherwise, I keep studying all the time, find new things, and incorporate into my program.
That's a much better way to spend your time than wasting life watching stuff.
Yeah. That's what I do all the time, is I find new technologies and study them, and then I incorporate as needed into the program. Like this day's thing is a four-month old addition. It's not that new.
Yeah. Okay.
Boy, this thing is really slow. Gee whiz.
I know.
Maybe it's my machine. Yeah. Is it my machine, or is it?
No, it's the service itself. Setting up services takes a lot of time. I know. And so it is painful, I understand.
Yeah, no problem.
But, you know, if people are getting bored, you can hang up. I don't mind.
No. No, this is, I want to get this finished anyhow. So.
Me too. Me too. I want it to work.
Now,
and I know it will work, but slow.
Yeah, Neelish, the other thing. And this is a little bit, we were talking a little bit offline. I can talk a little bit offline here too. So I did talk to my buddy whose wife is doing the cloud implementation for a company out in Spokane.
Uh-huh.
And I told him that we would be willing to assist. you know, no charge, all that kind of good stuff to help her get that thing going.
Uh-huh.
I haven't heard back. And the thing about her, she's a NIH kind of person, uh-huh. not invented here. And so I don't know what the response may be negative, just because she thinks she's the smartest person in the world. Though they've been working on it literally for a month now, and I don't think they have it up and running yet. She said it was, oh, this is really easy to set up. And so they set up their first virtual machine, and that's where I think they're at. So.
Okay.
Guys, I'll ask one more time, because she can be extremely difficult. Let's put it that way. So.
Wow.
There's my boop.
It's a very cool application, though. So to give you an idea of what they're doing, so what they do is they assist companies they set up the infrastructure, the database, and the tools so that power companies can sell and buy power and keep track of it. And there's a national, service that they have to follow to make that so it can be recorded and logged, and the National Energy Agency can actually look at it and say, yeah, you guys are doing the right thing.
Huh.
So a company in Spokane has asked them to actually set this up in the cloud for them. Take their service, move it into the cloud so that they don't have to implement any on-prem infrastructure. And that's what they're trying to do. And this is a fairly large database on an Oracle database. So
wow.
Kind of cool, actually. So
yeah, interesting. So you were talking to her about maybe identifying a project that you could do for her in the context of using cloud and things like that, right? If I recall.
Yeah, and helping her get it set up. Yeah.
Yeah, that would be nice if you can pull it off. If she agrees, that would be awesome.
Yeah. Yeah, she, you know, she's smarter than everybody else in the room, so sometimes it's hard to, even if it's for nothing.
Yeah, this weight game is really boring, man. Yeah, I'm so less impatient game, and I don't have any.
But you know, now what? So what are the next steps? Because if you want, what I can do is just continue to let this run.
Yeah, that's something we should maybe, you know, on the terminal, press Control T as in telephone, and open another window, and let us maybe do something in parallel. So press Control T in the terminal window to open another terminal.
Okay.
Or rather, use your mouse to right-click on the terminal in the section here and say New Terminal.
Okay.
And that will open up New Terminal. So let's see what steps we can do while this thing runs. We can proceed forward, such as...
Okay.
First one is to check if you have Days version installed already. So say Days enter, Days version enter. So this is different from Days Control, right? Days is a different utility than Days Control utility. So this version, is it installed? Not found. So which means we have to go to cd.
My workplace.
Yeah, so you have to type in cd followed by home user bin. So slash home slash user bin. Home user bin. Home user bin.
Oh.
So type in H-O-M-E, home.
Oh, I see. Home and then user bin. Okay, sorry.
Home slash user slash bin. That's the location you want to go to. And then type the curl command to install the Days Control. Not Days Control, but this is Days CLI. So the second line in curl SSL will get you. Curl SSL, that line. No, not the previous line, but this different line. In the write-up, in the write-up on the web browser, Edge browser.
Oh.
Yeah, that one, yes, the curl. This curl will grab the command line interface to Days. So to break it, Control C, and then paste. And this will grab the command line interface to Days CLI. and install it in the current folder. And then we will make it executable by the next step, which is coming up.
Yeah. Okay.
So the next step will make it executable. And so we'll do that. Copy and then paste that one will be Cloud Genius is the password. Yes. Now the real hardcore ones are still waiting, but we have Helen, Patrick, and Shikha still here with us. Everybody else is gone. I guess they want to watch the recording. So we will let them have fun. So yeah. Next step is to go, not that command, that is not going to work for you. So we'll go cd dot dot and then cd days. So that command will not work.
Oh gosh.
Go forward. Go forward will take you there. Yeah, forward two times should take you the right spot. I think you're tired.
Well, I was trying to.
So let me paste it for you. Yeah, let me cd dot dot enter, followed by cd and then DEIS.
There we go.
And then you have a link in Slack chat.
Okay. For some reason, I have a heck of a time finding those.
So you have a Slack application installed already right there. So just click on it, and then it should give you. Now here you have to log in probably. It'll ask you to log in. If you are not logged in, it'll make you log in. I think you are logged in on Edge browser.
You're right. Yeah. God, this is brutal. Okay. I think I can actually, come on, there we go. All I can do is just this. There we go.
That works. So now you're back in the place where you can get access to the write-up and on the other terminal.
Yeah.
In the new terminal you just opened, let us test for day's version. It should now work. Day's okay, version. So Days that dash version.
Where did it go? Yeah, and then DEIS days version.
Dash dash version. It should show you the version.
What?
Yep, version.
Oh right. Damn it. There we go. Right, version.
Yes.
There it is.
It showed you.
Yeah, okay.
Beautiful. Now let us see if there are other steps we can do while the thing is running. This is taking way more time than I expected. Okay.
So where are we at here? Let's see.
We have Days version checked, Days installed. Now we are going to use the Days app after it is ready. So we have to check for service and then This part is done. Using the Days client. Yeah, this we cannot do yet. We cannot do this step because we have to register the application with the username and a password and email and all that. That will not work if the services are not available. So this part will not work.
Right.
Okay. And you, in your machine, you will not type this command, the first one.
Right, okay.
Because something is wrong with your machine. So you will continue from this step onwards.
Okay.
Now let us see what's going on in the other terminal. And what I would suggest is you please type one enter one time in the terminal. One enter one time.
Okay, just one enter?
Yeah. Okay, couple more enters. Let's see if it is still active.
Yeah.
It is active.
So it's still
okay.
Okay.
Yeah. So what I would suggest is let me type this if I can type. Let us see if I can type this thing. TS-EF pipe grep base. The thing is running. Oh, man. It is taking so long.
Well, like I said, you know, if you want to, we can go ahead and let it run.
Yeah, let it run. Let us drop the call. Let us let it run, see what happens, and revisit. We'll do the whole thing again. In the meanwhile, I'll attempt to run this on my own. I don't want to keep you guys hanging like this. But leave the laptop running on a disable energy saving. So leave it running. Let's see what happens tomorrow, and let's talk.
Okay.
I want to break it. I will run this thing on my own here again and figure it out.
Okay, sounds good. And okay.
So I am for now I'm going to stop the recording and pass you the recording itself. We'll revisit. Okay. So chat with me tomorrow morning and see what happens.
Okay. Very good, Neelish. Have a good
evening. Bye.
Okay. Bye-bye. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Bye. Bye.